Kansas City, Missouri. ESPN's Wednesday Night Baseball presents the Detroit Tigers and the Kansas City Royals. Hello once again, everyone, and welcome to ESPN's Wednesday Night Baseball. I'm John Saunders. The Tigers on a mini roll. They've won three of their last four games. Kansas City going the other way. They've lost four games in a row. We'll get you out to Kansas City and Royal Stadium in just a moment. But first, the big news of the day involved Ricky Henderson. As you know, he has been stuck on 938 for a couple of days, trying to catch Lou Brock and pass him on the all-time list. In the first, a walk, he takes off, and Matt Noakes guns him down. So the record would have to wait. But in the fourth, with Ricky Henderson on second, he dons the goggles. That may be the key. Tim Leary facing Harold Baines. You watch Ricky Henderson take off. He's in there, and the record is his at 939. Now the all-time base-stealing king.
Lou Brock was the symbol of great base stealing. But today, I'm the greatest of all time.
216th time he's stolen third, but that was the key, 939. Ricky Henderson setting the record in 1,154 attempts in 12 seasons, or just short of 12. Lou Brock needed 19 years, 1,245 attempts. The A's won 7-4. Dave Henderson had his seventh home run. Meantime, here's a game that may never end. Yes, this is right. It's in the 19th inning. Six runs for Milwaukee in the bottom of the fifth inning. The White Sox had three in the 15th. Looked like they had this game wrapped up, but then the Brewers came back in the bottom half of the inning, and they got three, so it's still tied in the 19th. Meantime, the longest game ever was the Brewers and the White Sox. 25 innings on May 8th, 1984. The game lasting around 8 hours. We'll update that and all the games, some afternoon games in the National League on Wednesday Night Baseball.
League Baseball is brought to you by Budweiser, the king of beers. With that clean, crisp, cold taste, nothing beats a Bud. By Subaru, we built our reputation by building a better car. And by Turtle Wax, for a deep shine that lasts a year. Turtle Wax, the easy-to-use car wax.
Beautiful late spring day in Kansas City, Missouri, where tonight the Detroit Tigers and the Kansas City Royals will meet at Royal Stadium. The Tigers try to sweep a three-game series. Hello, everybody. Gary Thorne and Dave Campbell, and welcome to ESPN's Wednesday Night Baseball. Great to have you with us. Dave, for tonight, offensively, a couple of teams that are struggling.
Really are. The Detroit Tigers have figured with their great power they would lead the American League in homers and probably strikeouts, and they are leading in those two categories. But they're only hitting 228, and I think that's a concern to Sparky Anderson. The Royals on the other side of the coin are not hitting a lick. Their on-base percentage is pathetic. They just aren't scoring runs. They're getting decent pitching.
The pitching on these two teams is really something I think most fans would not realize. Last season, Detroit was last starter ERA, but the bullpen pretty decent. Kansas City, a decent staff in the middle of the pack. This year, good pitching both ways.
Really is. The Tigers, where they are in the standings, because of the excellent pitching they've had, especially that great bullpen, an ERA just over two. Kansas City on the other side of the coin, they've had some guys hurt, but they're still getting decent pitching, particularly from tonight's starter, Mike Boddicker. Boddicker 2-2 with a 2.03 earned run average. He has a variety of pitches. You're going to see changeups, fastballs, which is a forkball, a lot of sidearm curves. He really tries to finesse the hitters.
The Detroit Tigers, Tony Phillips leading it off, 356 on base percentage. Alan Trammell hitting 297 will start at short. His buddy of 14 years, Lou Whitaker, will be batting third at second. Cecil only had three home runs first month of the season. He bats cleanup, then the strikeouts. Mickey Tettelin will be doing the catching. Rob Deer hitting just 197 will be in right field. Pete Incaviglia hitting 170, the DH. Travis Fryman, Sparky says, I want to make him a ball player. He'll be at third. And Milt Kiler plays center and bats ninth.
Right-hander Mike Boddicker on the mound for the Kansas City Royals tonight. You see what he did with the Red Sox and what he meant to them. The Red Sox said, whatever it takes, we want to sign you. Boddicker said, no, I'm sorry. I want to go back closer to home. The catcher tonight for the Kansas City Royals is going to be Mike McFarland. Had a tough throwing year last year, but is throwing much better this year. Defensively, it'll be Bill Pakoda trying to fill in for Kevin Seitzer at third, with Stillwell, Shumpert, and Cromartie in the infield. And in the outfield, young Brian McRae will try to run down the mistakes in center, flanked by Jim Eisenreich and Danny Tartabull.
Well, this former Boston Red Sox pitcher, who had a great 17-8 record last season, off to that 2-2 start, and they want him to anchor this Kansas City staff. He has really held the opposition down. The opposing hitters are batting 183 against him right now. That is the fifth best in the league. And his ERA at 203 is 10th. Moniker will take on the Detroit Tigers, who have won their last two games, winning them here in KC. Tony Phillips, a seven-game hit streak, part of their offensive attack right now, and he leads it off after obliterating the back line. He's cleaned out everything the groundskeepers did for the last half hour. There you see his numbers. Tony wants to get to the back of the box, I do believe. 12 hits in his last 38 at-bats for him. Boddicker in with it. What a one.
Trying to figure out a way to hit Boddicker because he's only 3-for-27 lifetime, so maybe he figures if he moves back and can hold hands with John Hirschbeck, the home plate umpire, maybe that'll be the trick.
George Thomas Cruz got to love this. Thomas, one of the great groundskeepers in baseball history. Look what he did to the back lines. He took care of both sides. He's a switch hitter, so I guess he decided he's going to get it done just in case they changed pitchers before he came up again. Look at all that white he took out of there. Nice job, Tony. Phillips will be followed by Trammell and Whitaker as the Detroit Tigers on the longest road trip of the season. They'll lead it off with a base hit. Oh, he is on. Leadoff single.
Pat Dobson, the pitching coach of the Royals, talked about Mike Boddicker pitching to the Tigers tonight.
Well, you know, I think you'd be really surprised that, especially early in the year, he has a tendency to use his fastball and his changeup more than his breaking ball because he has a real tough time getting a feel for his curveball. But I think against those right-handers, you'll probably see him drop down a lot and throw a lot of sidearm curveballs and a lot of sidearm fastballs and changeups, and then just basically try and stay down in the strike zone if he can and stay out of the nitro zone.
I like that.
The nitro zone. He knows what he's talking about with guys like Cecil Fielder and Incaville and Tettleton and Rob Deere out of the nitro zone.
Lots of nitro zones coming up in this order. Alan Trammell, 4-for-24 lifetime against Boddicker with Phillips on at first base. Let's see how Sparky Anderson will play this one for Phillips. First of all, take a look at Trammell's numbers, and he is off to a very good start this season. Phillips, stolen base-wise, 1-for-2, off and going. That one is fouled off. Hit and run, run and hit, whatever you want. Trammell, who can move the ball around, was trying to put it in behind the runner. Dave and I had a great chance to sit and listen to Sparky Anderson before the game, about 45 minutes worth. That's what baseball's all about.
He talked about his great admiration for John McGraw, who managed 33 years in the major leagues. He said, you know that McGraw went over 2,800 games. That means in 28 years, he averaged close to 100 wins. He says, I'll never get there, but I have such admiration for the man.
And how many times did he say he's going to manage 10 more years? Trammell pops it up to shallow left center field. Shortstop back Stillwell will put it away. And it took Phillips back to first base. One down.
I think with the kind of record the Sparky's had, he pretty much can say how many years he wants to manage. You never know in this business, but he seems to have a terrific relationship with the front office, a good chain of command in Detroit with Jim Campbell, Bo Schembechler, and Sparky Anderson, and looks good for Sparky, I think, in the future in Detroit. He wants to stay there.
He wants another 10 years worth. There wasn't any question about that. Here's Whitaker, left-handed hitter. Boddicker with a runner at first and one out. The lineup, Phillips the switch hitter at the top, Whitaker left-handed, Tettleton's a switch hitter. Bottom of the order, Kyler's a switch hitter as well, but it hasn't made much difference against Boddicker thus far this season. Towards first foul, left-handers are hitting 175 off Boddicker and the right-handers 188. They've had two home runs off him this season. Both of them have been hit by right-handers.
He really is the master of the change of speed. Pat Dobson saying he's going to throw more fastballs and changeups than curveballs early on. He says the Tigers have been a tough team for him the past, but they have a lot of new faces, so maybe that won't hold true.
0-1 the count. Dave, one of the things tonight, if you go by the ground ball, fly ball hitter matchups, the Detroit Tigers should ladle Boddicker. He is a distinct ground ball pitcher. Detroit is the most fly ball hitting like team in the major leagues.
Well, that isn't tough to figure with the home run sluggers they have. A lot of guys that swing up on the ball, Cecil Fielder, Tettleton, Incaviglia, and Deere just starting out. The Tigers have six players in their lineup tonight that have hit at least 24 home runs in a single season, so they are laden with power.
22 home runs for that Detroit Tiger team, and they had a couple in last night's 13-7 win that had a couple of hours worth of rain delay. The teams did not get out of Royal Stadium last night until, well, actually the game didn't finish till after 12:20. So it went on for a long time. That's the second in three nights that they've had extensive rain delays. It happened Sunday night. ESPN was broadcasting here. They had a 2.5-hour rain delay.
I mentioned Mike McFarland throwing better this year, but you also see Boddicker utilizing the slide step, and that's a trademark of pitching coach Pat Dobson. The Royals have only given up 5 stolen bases this year. Last year, McFarland only threw 17% with that slide step. He'll improve that a great amount this year.
Makes such a difference for the catchers if the pitcher's getting the ball to the mound.
And for those of you who say, what the heck is a slide step, it basically is just eliminating the high leg kick. The pitcher just comes set and then just basically steps towards the plate. No high leg kick coming out of the set position.
See McFarland looking over. He's getting signs from the Kansas City dugout here for what John Wathan, Pat Dobson, wants Boddicker to throw.
Would figure that Phillips would run here. 3-2, one out. Phillips, pretty good speed. Figure he's going to run in this situation, try to avoid the double play, get the infield moving.
Runner goes, and that's fouled off as Whitaker got out in front of that, puts it in the seats.
Whitaker, good night last night with 3 hits. Last year, he was hitting 184 in June, so he's off to a much better start this year.
Good slide step, Dave.
Again, watch how Boddicker, instead of getting the high leg kick, just basically steps towards the plate. And that really cuts down on the time of the pitcher delivering to the catcher, gives the catcher a legitimate chance. Last year, the Royals had a lot of guys with the high leg kick. And again, McFarland had a tough year throwing.
Phillips at first being held. He's off again. And Whitaker goes the other way. And they weren't playing him there. That'll fall in. Jim Eisenreich cannot cut it off. Tony Phillips will come around to score. And down to second base goes Whitaker. A double and an RBI. And just 3 batters to the plate, and the Tigers lead 1-0.
I agree with all the scoring except for the RBI. To me, that should be a double, but when Eisenreich misplayed it, there's no way that Phillips would have scored on the play, but the official scorer says double RBI. Get a chance to look at it again. Again, the Royals outfield playing Whitaker to pull against a soft-tossing Boddicker, but right there, Eisenreich short-legged the ball just a little bit down there.
So Whitaker continues. If you look at Eisenreich, would like to have played that cleanly, probably would have held that runner. And here is Cecil Fielder. Whitaker continues to hit Boddicker now, 14 for 44 lifetime. He's on at second base with one away. There you see the numbers. Good average. The home runs down from 7 that he had last season. In the first month of the year, only 3 dingers thus far this season.
Tough thing against a guy like Mike Boddicker, and you saw Cecil Fielder on the first pitch kind of talk to himself about keeping the shoulder in. Boddicker throws that arm out at you, and you really have a tendency to jump out at the ball, and it's just not there. The key is staying back on him.
Oh, he didn't stay back on that one. I'm not sure anybody could have. You'd need elastic in your legs to catch that pitch.
Again, talking to Dobson before the game, I said, game plan for Boddicker against the big guys. He said, slow, slower, and slowest. And that is the sidearm breaking ball, about 60 miles an hour, maybe, probably closer to 50, and Cecil could not stay back.
19 strikeouts now for Cecil Fielder as the Tigers continue to pile those up. That was a 59-mile-an-hour changeup.
Oh, excuse me, my eyes were going bad.
2 down now, runner at second base, and there's more of the breaking ball, this time to Tettleton, who is the switch hitter, batting .286 right-handed, only .171 left-handed, but both of his home runs have come from this side of the plate. And another off-speed pitch is in.
Mickey figures to be patient. He looked at more pitches per at-bat than any hitter in Major League Baseball last year. 106 walks, 160 strikeouts, and when he did put it in play, not as good as the year before when he hit 26 home runs for the Orioles.
Good stop by McFarland. If you're wondering about these strikeouts for Detroit, which will be the story all season with the Tigers, Fielder's strikeout, they have now upped it to 133. At the current pace, They would strike out 1,056 times, which would be well below the 1,200 strikeouts the Mets set in 68. But it's early in the season.
Yeah, they haven't seen Ryan or Pascoe or some of those Western Division pitchers, Hanson, some of those guys yet.
Yep, that's exactly right.
One thing about the Tiger Club this year, though, they are going to be fun. I think the fans are going to get their money's worth in Detroit just coming out and watching these guys, because you never know if you go out there if you're going to see six home runs or 15 strikeouts.
There's a fastball, and Tuttleton was not looking for that. The count is full. Three balls, two strikes, a run in here in the first inning. Whitaker, who had the RBI, waiting at second base. Lou Whitaker now, nine runs batted in on the season. Boniker trying to get out of the first inning. 3-2 off the fist. Shortstop Stillwell is there. Puts it away. But the Detroit Tigers get one in their first at-bat, picking up the run and a couple of hits with a runner left at second base. 7-5 in the series last season, but the Tigers have won the last four games at KC. For John Wathan's Royals, Warren Cromartie, hot start. He'll be leading it off at first base. Bill Pakoda will be playing at third and batting second. Danny Tartable hitting .288 in right field. Kirk Gibson, great start, bats gone silent. He'll be the DH. Jim Eisenreich will make the start in left field. He's hitting. Mike McFarland, maybe the most improved Royal early on. He'll do the catching. Kurt Stillwell, .317 average. He's at short. Brian McRae struggling at the plate, batting eighth in center. Terry Shumpert also struggling with a stick at second base.
Tiger pitcher tonight, right-hander Bill Gullickson, 6'3", 220. He is 32 years old. He spent last year with Houston after being in Japan for 2 years. A few of these players have been in Japan and are playing in tonight's game. Gullickson last year, in his 14 losses with the Astros, Houston never scored more than two runs in any of those losses. A catcher, Mickey Tettleton. He is calling the pitches for Bill Gullickson tonight. Checking the Tiger infield, Alan Trammell, a four-time Gold Glove winner at shortstop, positions himself so well. Cecil Fielder, Luke Whitaker, and Travis Fryman round out the infield. Milt Kiler, a speedster. He made a tremendous catch here last night off Warren Cromartie with the bases loaded. He'll have to patrol quite a bit of territory. Tony Phillips in left, and Rob Deer in right field has a good throwing arm. And there's young Milt Kiler, the speedster. Not too much with a stick, but he can run him down.
Well, Gullickson with a run to work with as he goes to the bottom half of the first inning. Cromartie, talking about people who spent some years in Japan, this 37-year-old spent 7 years there. And he goes after the first pitch, Lou Whitaker. And there's one away here in the first inning, keeping us up to date on long ball games. John Saunders.
And you talk about veterans coming through. Willie Randolph singled in the tying run in the 15th. And then in the 19th, with the bases full, Edwards to Willie Randolph knocks it through. Jim Gantner comes in to score. And finally, 10-9 is the final with the run in the bottom of the 19th. Willie Randolph the hero. And right now, let's take you back to Kansas City to Gary and Dave.
And it was freezing cold in Milwaukee.
It took the Brewers 7 years to pay the White Sox back for that 25-inning game in 1984 when Harold Baines won it with a home run. But the Brewers finally got even today.
Yeah, they did it. Freezing cold up there with that wind coming off the lake. Here's Bill Pakoda. Pakoda getting playing time here at third base. As the pitch by Gullickson is taken away, a ball and a strike. Here, it couldn't be nicer. I mean, it has been a magnificent day. Just beautiful blue skies here in Kansas City. It was up about 74, 75 degrees today. It's been just great. Chopped to short. Trammell. We've seen two of the best in the infield, Whitaker and Trammell. Two outs.
Don't think that the impression that Cecil Fielder made on the major leagues last year coming back in Japan didn't make a difference. That opened the gate for a guy like Warren Cromartie to come back. Tony Bernazard with the Tigers. And Bill Gullickson had come back the year before, and he certainly pitched well with the Astros a year ago. So you're seeing more players now coming back from Japan. You didn't see that very often in the past.
Cecil had as big a chaw as that in Japan. That is so ugly. Come on, Cecil. Two down, nobody on, and here's Tartable. Batting .288 and off to a good start. Gullickson throws strikes. Last season, walked only 61, struck out just 73. He gives his fielders something to work with. Seen a couple of ground balls already here. Carnival takes the strike.
Most home runs any buddy had hit coming back from Japan was Bobby Jones with 13, and it took him 6 years to get the 13 before Cecil came back to bang 51 last year.
Quadrupled his numbers. Tigers leading it 1-0, two out here, and there's the first hit for the Royals as Carnival socks one to center. Kyler's up with it. One of the things to keep an eye on tonight, and I thought of it as that line drive went to center. The outfielders, you cannot let a ball play you. This carpet is alive. This is a ping pong stadium. A lot of extra base hits. It is not a home run hitter's yard, but a ton of extra base hits. About 20% more than you get in other parks. And you'll see the ball when it goes by outfielders just run around for what seems like forever.
Kind of surprising in a way that the Tigers have played so well in Royal Stadium because they are not known as a speed team. And you have to have fast outfielders to cover the gaps. Kyler's got a lot of room to cover in center.
Here is Kirk Gibson. The acquisition to make him forget about Bo. And Gibson did that early on. He has struggled at the plate of late after starting out like a house of fire. Been on top in home runs and RBIs for the Royals, and in fact in the league, Gibson 6 home runs tied with Dave Henderson starting today's play, and he's producing RBIs as well. So Gibson doing that part of the job. Dave Henderson had one today to take the lead back from Gibson. You see Deer also in this game right there with 5, and Vaughn Yount and Cal Ripken. 1-1 here, 2 down, runner at first base. Gullickson to Gibson, fisted him. Shortstop, Trammell wants it. And that'll do it. No runs on a base hit and one left on. We've completed one here in Kansas City with the Tigers up 1-0.
Bruce Hurst spent much of his career in the American League hitting 091 facing Frank Viola, another left-hander, and gets all wood on this one. Past Tommy Herr, Darren Jackson comes in to score. As Bruce Hurst is trying to get his team back. 3-2 now is the score in the fifth inning. So back to Gary and Dave.
The New York Mets, second base now available. Greg Jeffries has got a bad rib cage muscle pull, and he's out of there. Detroit leading here by a score of 1-0. Rob Deer will lead it off against Boddicker. Deer, Incavilia, and Fryman. Deer against Boddicker lifetime, 6 hits, including 1 home run in 30 at-bats. And he tags that one to deep center field. Back on it, McRae has room and hauls it in. He was a little in front of that. He got a lot of wood on it.
Rob, a grand slam last night. Drove in 5 runs, also had a bases loaded walk. Just gets it out on the end of the bat. Boy, he had a good swing, but did not quite get the big wood on it.
Well, he didn't strike out. 29 strikeouts for Deer already this season. Here's Incavilia. Inky's up to 14 strikeouts, but that has never concerned him very much. What's bothering him right now is that he's had only 2 hits in his last 29 times at bat. Right now, Tuttle and Deer, Incavilia are struggling. You see that 170 average and only the 1 home run for Incavilia. He homered in his first Tiger start. Let's give him some work. McRae, see how much room there is to cover, but it is there to cover. It's 4-10 all the way around center field.
Ryan got a good jump. Tigers hit the first 2 pitches here in the top half of the second inning. Let's see if Fryman takes a pitch. Right in the hitting zone. Incavilia has great power to right center field. Tigers have had a couple of good swipes, but it stayed in the ballpark.
Fryman at the plate, the 22-year-old. Sparky Anderson is really excited about Travis Fryman. He's struggling at the plate here, 0 for his last 13. And he tags that, and it will be foul. Sparky says this is a project on a ball player he thinks is going to be a star.
Well, Sparky loves to work with young players. He says, hey, I got Fryman and Kyler, and he says, I have some tremendous men on this baseball team. He says, it's not the best baseball team I've ever had. But he said, it's my favorite team as far as the players, their personalities, and the effort.
Fryman played 66 games last season at 297 with the Tigers. The other part of the season spent with the Toledo Mud Hens, their AAA club. He has switched from shortstop to third. And he got out in front of that one. Rakota at third base waiting for it. It'll be played in fair territory, and Boniker has a great second inning, retiring the side in order with a little help from McRae in center. Jim Eisenreich, who's on a tear at the plate, has a 9-game hit streak coming into this game tonight. He's gone 14 for 41. That's a .341 average, and he leads the Royals with 22 hits. And Gullickson goes outside on him. Jim Eisenreich's a great story. He's had to work his way back and back and back again, and he's become a very solid player for the Kansas City Royals. Taps that one. Gullickson can't get it. Tough play. Trammell, there is none. Infield single, 10-game hit streak for Eisenreich, and the leadoff man is on in the second inning.
Turf hit.
Yep.
AstroTurf hit. Just over Gully's outstretched glove, and Trammell had to come too far. Eisenreich runs very well. Gullickson stretches the 6-foot, 3-inch frame, but not enough. And once this hits the third time, Trammell has no play.
This club is made for the artificial surface, since that's what they have here. This season, the Eisenreich stealing bases, he can go. This season, Kansas City is hitting .292 on the artificial carpet. You know what they're hitting on grass fields? .193. And that is not unusual for a Royals team that likes to put the ball down on the carpet. They'll try and bounce some hits through on you.
Notice the percentage on Eisenreich last year was not good. Only 12 out of 26, 46%. That was the third worst in the American League. But the year before, he stole 31. And they tell us he just got a lot of bad reads on pitchers last year.
Jim fakes the go this time, and the pitch is taken inside by another hot hitter. McFarland checking at third for the signs. Adrian Garrett going through the routine. McFarland has a 7-game hit streak in which he has batted .435. Four doubles, four RBIs during this streak, and he's always been tough against the Tigers. .368 career average against Detroit.
Mike McFarland has nothing but glowing praise for his mentor, Bob Boone. He said Boone knew he was the heir apparent. Bob did everything with him, taught him everything he knew about catching, and holds him in great respect.
John Wathen says he is the most improved player early on. The pitch out, Tedelin calling for it, runner not going. Wathen says, I truly believe McFarland has come to the point where he is ready to be the everyday catcher for a long time to come.
Yeah, the one thing that McFarland says that Boone really taught him was mental toughness, the ability to call any pitch at any given situation and have the confidence you can block that pitch and keep your pitcher in the game. A lot of catchers cop out, call the fastball with a man on third base.
Out in front of that, fouls it back. There'll be no play on it. Oh, Booney's got to be one of the great teachers in the game. Gullickson with a 2-1 count here, nobody out. Farland's only 26 years old. He played 124 games last season, which was a career high for him. He has always been the catcher in wait for Kansas City. Came up to the big club in 87 and has been here or AAA since then. Eisenreich on at first, nobody out. Runner goes, foul back. 2-2.
Tigers had Trammell on the cover. He saw the fastball sign from Tettleton, figured that McFarland was going to try to go to the opposite way. So Alan Trammell was on the cover. Don't always go right and left. Pitch selection, tendencies of the hitter. And Trammell, who's been around 14 years, and Whitaker, too. We know these hitters.
Great double play combination. 14 years together. Whitaker and Trammell up the middle. And now they've got Kyler, the youngster, out in center. 2-2 count. Runner not going, and he's gone and knew it. Gullickson gave him a fastball, and McFarland is called out on strikes. First strikeout for Gullickson, who will not get many. That's his ninth of the season.
Well, Gully, like Boddicker, known as a breaking ball pitcher, he has thrown 15 fastballs out of the first 18 pitches, and I think a lot of the Royals are sitting there going, where's the hook? Where's the slider?
It's a good game plan sometimes. Confuse them in the first go-around and then go back to what you normally throw after that. Try and keep them guessing a little bit. One away. Tigers lead 1-0 here in the bottom of the second inning. Each team with a couple of hits. Gullickson now working. This is still well. Gullickson has an unusual number. His strikeouts last season were 3.4 per nine innings, which was the lowest among National League starting pitchers. Yet, the rookie record for strikeouts in a game, he owns it. He had 18. So he threw them all in the first year and in one game. And since then, he's had to act with it.
The Cubbies, 1980.
Now he makes them hit it. He doesn't walk people either, so he doesn't need the strikeouts.
Teammate with the Yomiuri Giants, Cecil Fielder, so he and Gullickson played together in 1989. Take that back. Cecil didn't play with that club. It was Cromartie.
That one to left field. Phillips. Shoe top, backhanded no less. That one really dove on him. Eisenreich back to the bag. Now there are two down after his leadoff single.
Nice play by Tony Phillips. He has started in six different positions so far this year. He is the most valuable Tiger probably all around. No matter where Sparky puts him, he does a job defensively. He's played third, short, second, left, center, right. He's also DH. So Tony Phillips, just on May 1st, has already played six positions for the Detroit Tigers this year.
That'll get you out early. You don't know if you're supposed to practice ground balls or pop-ups. Two down here. Eisenreich on at first base. And here's Brian McRae.
Well, the one thing a utility player has to do that's going to play that often is each day you come to the ballpark, when you look at that position, then you have to go through kind of a mental checklist. If I'm in the infield, what do I do on relays and cutoffs? What do I do on bunt plays? You always have to think about the position you're going to play that night, what your responsibilities are.
He squared around, would be bunting for the base hit here with two down. Let's that one go. Brian McRae, going to be an outstanding ball player. If you listen to anyone who has watched him play, Wathen says his defense for Kansas City has been nothing short of phenomenal. He has chased down all kinds of fly balls. You saw him nab a couple in the last inning in center. Runner goes, 1-0, squared to protect, throw. Tuttleton is there, and he's gone. Eisenreich is thrown out as Mickey Tuttleton put that one on the money. And that'll do it in the second. Tigers leading 1-0.
Trying to get even for last night's loss in Cincinnati. And Bobby Bonilla doing most of the damage here in the second against Jose Rio. This is a home run. O'Neill goes up just over his glove. Bonilla has a double and a single as well. Could we see the cycle tonight? Looking for the triple. Right now it's 3-3 in the seventh. Back to Gary and Dave.
And here the Detroit Tigers are leading Kansas City 1-0 as we go to the top of the third inning. It's a great night for cotton candy and helmets.
In fact, he needs to wipe his hands. He can come up and do it on my pants. I've already spilled about three things on him.
I was going to say, supper must have been really good because you obviously were trying to get it down as quick as you could.
Absolutely. Decorated myself. Hey, once you have the great hands, you just never lose.
That's right. Another 22-year-old for the Tigers. Fryman's 22. Kyler's 22. Batting eighth and ninth in the order. Kyler is a switch hitter. And we were talking about center fielders McRae with speed. Kyler also has that speed in the outfield. Breaking ball bounces. That was a slower than slow. 2-1. Kyler's batting 375 right-handed. Just 188 from the left side where he's getting most of his at-bats. He's had only one extra base hit among the 10 hits he's had. That was a double, came left-handed. And Boniker didn't want to go 3-1 on him, and does. Slaps that right back to the mound. Boniker's got it. The gold glove pitcher makes the play, and Kyler's retired, one away here in the third.
Mike Boniker off to a much better start than usual. Part of the reason may be that slick fielding, and it's no accident he won the gold glove. You saw him handle that hot comebacker. He gets himself in an excellent fielding position, and that helps keep those ERAs down.
Helped himself out and got the first out here, and that'll bring up Phillips, whom he did not get out in the first inning. A leadoff single scored on the double by Whitaker. Since then, six in a row have been retired by Boniker. That'll be fouled outside of first. Boniker lifetime, 120 wins and 97 losses. Last year, 1-1 against Detroit, and lifetime 6-12 against the Tigers.
I think Tony likes it away from home. The Tigers, as Gary told you, completing their longest road trip of the year. It was scheduled for 13 games, rained out in New York, but they're 6-5 and trying to walk away with a winning road trip here.
Dave, he's like everybody else on this team. This Tiger team in eight games at home hit 192. Yet despite that, they are 4-4. In road games, the Tigers are batting 253 on the road. Those may even up since we're very early on, but pretty good difference even early. Towards short. Grass cutter. There was grass. Stillwell, two down.
Kurt, it seems though he's been around forever, but he's only 25 years old. He came up with the Cincinnati Reds when he was 19. He played in the All-Star game his first year over here in Kansas City. He was traded for Danny Jackson. And boy, the Royals. We talk about some pitchers that have gotten away. They have guys who have gotten away like David Cone, Greg Hippard, Melito Perez, Scott Bankhead, Charlie Liebrandt, Jose DeJesus, Bud Black, and all they had to show for it, Danny Tartabull and Kurt Stillwell. So they've lost some pitchers.
Some real good ones, as it's proven to be, have departed Kansas City uniform. Two down here with nobody on. He likes the number two spot. Popped out his first time up. Bases are empty. The 2-0 hits the outside corner. Two balls and one strike.
I'm in good company with Spilling, though. I was talking to a couple of Detroit writers laughing in the press room about it. They said, hey, what, you've been hanging around Alan Trammell? I guess he spills everything all over his clothes.
Oh, nice pitch. Trammell scooting away on Boniker as that one got away, but it was slow enough so he can laugh.
Sidearm backup curveball. Allen didn't know whether to go back or forward. Hey, great agility. Natural instinct is to go the other way.
You don't laugh when they're over your head, but that one wasn't. Cromartie at first will not have a play on that. Trammell will keep his at-bat alive with 3-2 and two down. Shirt sleeve crowd on hand here tonight, hoping that Kansas City Royals can get out of this four-game funk. They are 1-4 in this homestand, and they've got the Toronto Blue Jays coming in here for four games over the weekend, so it's not going to get any easier.
Think the Duke is on the hot seat, John Watham?
No. 3-2, and he walked him.
I figure if he survived last year, this is the last year of his contract, though.
Yep, you're right, and his name will be mentioned if the Royals do not improve. I think he is so respected here right now that he's probably got a little more tether than coaches in a similar situation would have, managers would. He's a good one.
Tough year last year. Danny Tartabull, Saberhagen, Gubiza, Boone all in the DL at one time. Mark Davis didn't pitch like they thought he would. It was a tough year for the Royals. First time they'd finished below fourth since they came into existence in 1969.
They do have troubles with the DL. Whitaker up. He delivered the RBI double in the first inning. Runner on at first base is Trammell. See what he has done lifetime against Boniker, and it is a lot. Each team with a couple of hits. Jammed him. Good play by McFarland. They checked to see if he went. Ted Hendry, the third base umpire, says no. And Kansas City still going through problems with the DL. It may not be as long, but it's as serious. Of course, George Brett is out. The torn medial collateral ligament. He's here doing what he can at the ballpark, keeping in shape. Kevin Seitzer on the DL. Broken finger. Mark Gubiza is out, fouled off. Mark Davis is on the DL with a broken left finger, a ring finger. Jackson, of course, is gone, signed by the Chicago White Sox, but that's a big foursome to be out.
Got that right. Gubiza pitching tonight in Omaha, and the Royals are anxiously awaiting the results.
That one towards the gap in left center field near the wall. That'll take a hop up and off with two down on the fly. And coming home with the Tigers' second run, Alan Trammell. And Whitaker's done it again. Back-to-back doubles in times at bat, both producing an RBI, and the Tigers lead 2-0.
Tigers might have caught a break there. That ball looked like it might bounce over the fence for a ground rule double, in which case Trammell would have had to go back to third, but it bounced off the top of the fence. Boniker goes away from Whitaker, and Lou goes right with it to the alley in left center. McRae, no chance. He's going to have to play the carom. And you see how high that ball hit, about 3 feet below from bouncing over.
So Whitaker continues to tear up Boniker. It's one of those situations where Boniker's got to think about not even pitching to him. There's a runner on. And he did it with two down for the Tigers' third hit and second run. Now Fielder, who struck out, the only strikeout Boniker has. And boy, that walk to Trammell. Two down, came back to haunt.
Boy, he's got Cecil messed up. First time up, he threw him nothing but slow curveballs. Cecil goes up and looks off speed, and he gets a fastball right down the horn.
Breaking ball way outside this time. One ball and one strike. Whitaker with 10 RBIs now and four doubles. So in two at-bats in this game, he's doubled his two-bagger production on the season.
At least five straight hits for Louie. He was 3-for-3 last night. So he started last night at 226. He's up around 320 right now.
Bad against the Tigers. Two balls and one strike. 2-0 lead for Detroit. As they go after the sweep, they are 10-9, just a game and a half out of first place. They'd love to go home to a three-game win streak. 2-1. Reached for it. Stillwell makes the throw in time. And Fielder's retired, but the two-out walk to Trammell, he scored on the RBI double by Whitaker. Thank you, John. It's a 2-0 Detroit lead here as Gullickson will go to work on McRae, who was at the plate when Eisenreich was thrown out by Mickey Tettelin. So McRae gets to start over again, and he will try and put one down if he can. He is struggling at the plate right now. 23 years old, jumped up from double A ball to the major league level. That is never an easy jump, no matter how talented you are. 0-1 is there. No balls, two strikes. He wears number 56 and says, I'm going to wear it for my entire career. His dad's number was 11. What do 5 and 6 add up to? The 0-2 towards first. Oh, he can bend over. And he gullicks in, takes the toss. Fielder to his right. Those of you who say, hasn't he put on weight? Well, not enough so he can't feel the position.
The very agile Cecil Fielder makes a good play on the backhand side, and Gullickson just barely gets there in front of Brian McRae. The boy, Cess. Gives a good lead toss to Gullickson, and Bill gets on there and avoids the spikes of McRae.
I've kidded him a couple of times tonight. This guy has a great sense of humor. I'm afraid last season, with all that happened when the press was around him on the home runs, following him every day, and at one point he didn't want to talk to him, may have gotten a reputation as someone who wasn't dealing with the press, but I'll tell you, never had a problem with him, and he's always got a big smile on his face. Why shouldn't he?
And made no noises about renegotiating a contract.
Nope.
An oddity in itself.
That's right. Shumpert trying to get out of an 0-for-7. Fryman's going to make him 0-for-8. And there are two down here in the third inning. Let's check in with John.
And Budweiser now takes you to Shea Stadium in New York, where the Padres have come all the way back. Darren Jackson with the suicide squeeze scoring Benito Santiago. And the Padres, who were down 3-0 in this game, now lead it 5-3 in the sixth. Let's get it back to Gary and Dave.
Thank you, John. The Padres trying to regain first place as they go on the East Coast swing. And that's beating them in the first game of that series. Two down and nobody on in the top of the order. Here's Warren Cromartie, who grounded out his first time up. Six hits in his last 16 at-bats and a .292 average.
Padres trying to snap a four-game losing streak. The Phillies wiped him out three in a row after the Padres won the opening game.
And he's on again. And he's going to go to second base on Kyler. There's a rookie mistake. Kyler nonchalant of the ball in center field, and the veteran Warren Cromartie, 7 in Japan, 7 in the majors, took advantage of it.
Well, I can hear the talk now. It'll be after the game or before the game tomorrow night, and it will start out, son, we cannot afford to fall asleep. Sparky Anderson says this is a project, and Sparky will pick the right time to talk to Kyler and make sure he understands that we don't get lackadaisical in the outfield.
Get a guy like Cromartie. He's always watching. It'll be a double for Cromartie. Pushing his average up by 300, and Pakoda's up. That is the third hit off Gullickson. Cromartie is no slouch. He hit 321 in Japan and 280 in the 7 years before those 7 years at the major league level. He is a very good hitter. And he's getting it done. Only the second game he's been in the leadoff spot as the Royals still looking for a leadoff batter. They want McRae in that position, but they've got to give the kid a chance to find his bat.
Warren said he did some leading off when he was with Montreal back in 1981. Tim Raines was injured, and Cromartie led off for about 30 games, so he said, I'm not a complete stranger to that spot.
Rakota ahead on the count. Two balls, no strikes, two down. A 2-0 Tiger lead. Chance for a two-out RBI here. Rakota check swing, though, right back to Gullickson. The awe from the fans, and that will do it. Rakota's 0 for 2. No runs despite the double. The runner left on at second base. Tigers hang on to that 2-0 lead after three.
ESPN Major League Baseball is brought to you by John Deere Lawn Care Dealers. Stop by your local dealer to see why nothing runs like a deer. By Bounty, the taste of paradise in milk and dark chocolate. And by ProGuard Gasoline Additives for a smoother running engine.
It's the Missouri River Queen. You might want to take a ride on here. She goes up and down the Missouri River, 3 or 4 cruises a day all year long. Actually about 12 miles on the longest cruise, but what a day. I would have gone on that if I could have gotten to it. Tuttleton up.
One of those T names.
One ball, one strike.
Same number of syllables, isn't it?
Same one. Three innings complete, 2-3-0 for the Tigers. 0-3-0 for the Royals. Boniker a walk and a strikeout. Fouled off. While Gullickson has not walked anybody and struck out one. Yeah, he has struggled against him, including the 9 Ks. Tuttleton popped out his first time up. Tuttleton, Deer, and Incavilla. And there's the breaking ball, tried to time it. Pretty good wood, but again, it's a deep center field. And McRae hauls it in. He had a double clutch on that. Tuttleton's out of there, one down in the fourth. Here in their home yard, Kansas City Royals, 5-6 on this season. They were 45-36 last year at home, but boy, in the tough division they are in, they finished 75-86 and were 27.5 games out of first place.
Mentioned it was the first time they had ever finished below fourth, and we're talking about an expansion franchise. A lot of people figured this was the model expansion franchise. Look what they did, the management, the type of players they got. 1970s and 80s, they had the best winning percentage in the Western Division of the American League.
Deer fouls it off, no play. Boniker ahead on the count, no balls and two strikes. The Kansas City Royals realize they have not played against their own division yet this season.
Yeah, they're the odd man out in the early going.
So you figure you're going to pick up some wins maybe against what's supposed to be the weaker division, but it doesn't work that way. Kansas City 8-11. Detroit, on the other hand, this will be their second series against a Western Division opponent. They went 2-3 against the White Sox and now trying to sweep Kansas City. Missed that one inside. So John Wathen's team knows they've got another very tough 4-game series coming up with Toronto coming in here over the weekend. 2-2 delivery. Look out. That's the second backdoor job we've seen Boniker try to put in somebody's back pocket. This time it was Deer. First it was Trammell.
Yeah, in case you're wondering why the hitters aren't charging the pitchers, you don't charge pitchers on backup sidearm slow curveballs. I mean, those balls are just getting away from Boniker. Mike's release point is really messed up on that sidearm hook.
Wasn't that called the Boogaloo back in the 60s? That's a pretty good move right there. Deer, the 3-2, and down to third. That is a foul ball. Backdoor shots. There's Trammell, who was at the plate the first time Boniker put one behind him and had a big smile on his face. That time Deer didn't smile quite as big, but he knew it wasn't going to hurt him even if it hit him. Deer, 5 home runs leading the Tigers in that department, and he stays off the high one. And that'll be the second walk given up by Boniker. And with one away, the Tigers, with their 2-0 lead, have another base runner on it.
Last year, Deer only hit 170 with 11 home runs against right-handed pitching. He mashed on lefties. But this year, out of the 5 home runs, 4 of them have been against right-handed pitching. Last year, 293, 16 home runs against the lefties, and really struggled against right-handed pitching.
Take that pad off on the right arm. Obviously, has a bruise there wrapped up. Doesn't want that shield on when he's running the bases, though. Pete Incavilla. Bad numbers, aren't they? Inky 0 for 1 in this one. Got bent by the Boniker curve and is behind on the count 0-1.
Question of the day is, if you're going to have a baseball fight, least likely team, Tigers or Oakland A's? 20-point toss-up?
Would be one of the best matchups the heavyweights could offer at this point. 0-1, broken bat behind the mound. Step on it, Stillwell, and over to first for the double play. So Incaviglia hitting into the double play. The walk does not matter, and the Tigers have a 2-0 lead. Danny Tartable will lead it off. Tartable, Gibson, and Eisenreich. Gullickson in with a strike. Tartable had the single, was left stranded. Two have been left on by the Royals. That's all against Gullickson, who had been getting tagged pretty well here in his, despite the 2-0 record. Opposition hitting 307 coming into tonight's game against Gullickson. Tartable fouls that one off, and it'll end up in the seats.
Gullickson, who played in Japan, thought so much of one of his teammates, Masumi Kuwata, he named his youngest son Craig his middle name. Kind of unusual, but it was kind of respect for one of his teammates over in Japan.
So what's the youngster's name?
Craig Kuwata Gullickson.
About the second grade, the kid's going to go home and say, Dad, I know he was a good friend, but give me a break. The 0-2 right off the fist. Whitaker's got him. John Suwatsa Saunders.
Nobody giving the Pirates a break in this game. Seventh inning, Stan Belinda tied up 3-3. Barry Larkin takes it deep to left. Barry Bonds is back but can't get to it. Off the wall. Chris Sabo scores easily. Larkin winds up on third with a triple. He's 4-for-4 in the game. Two singles, a triple, and a home run. So he's looking for the double for the cycle. Back to Gary and Dave.
John, okay, what's updated on what's going on around the different ballparks? Those completed and those going on as Kirk Gibson steps in, and Dave has a trivia question.
No, I was just going to say last cycle for the Reds was Eric Davis, last cycle for the Pirates, Gary Reedus, and what do Kirk Gibson and Joe Carter have in common?
Neither of their children have a middle name.
Kuwata.
Gibson to right field. Here started in, backs up a couple of steps. Was that tagged? Almost took his glove off.
Well, believe it or not, Kirk Gibson and Joe Carter. Joe Carter, who's led the major leagues in RBI since 1986, have never made an All-Star team.
That is amazing.
Gibson, MVP, 1988 National League. No All-Star team.
Gibson retired, two down now in the fourth inning. The way he started this season, looked like he was going to make the All-Star team, and he may be able to do that this season. He keeps putting the power numbers up there. Eisenreich batting .329 now. 10-game hit streak as he continued it with a single his first time up. Fouls it back. Kansas City Royals obviously are getting a bit frustrated. See what Eisenreich's done at home and away. The Royals with that 4-game losing streak coming into this. Getting, as we said, some pretty decent pitching and getting 7 runs last night and losing by 6. To center field. Kyler at the wall. Room makes the catch and hangs on. That is a 400-foot plus fly ball, and I mean dead center. There is Kyler waiting on deck while he was in the outfield. Look at this catch to end the inning.
He may hit 250, but he earns his spurs. And this is the catch he made on Warren Cromartie last night with the bases loaded to basically save the game for the Tigers.
And that's some kind of play. And he came up with it and showed it. Meanwhile, Fryman leads it off. First ball hitting as he picks up the single up the middle. So there goes his 0 for 14. So he takes care of that with a leadoff single in the fifth inning. And the Tigers have picked up their fourth hit. Phillips scored in the first inning on a leadoff single doubled home by Whitaker. Trammell walked in the third, doubled home by Whitaker. Fryman leads off with a single here. And Kyler comes to the plate. And grounded out his first time up. So Boniker been touched up for timely hits in this game and one expensive walk. Runner goes, butting. No play at second. They'll get the out at first with Cromartie coming over to cover. A sacrifice for Kyler. Let's check in. John Saunders.
Blue Jays in the Texas Rangers. Third inning, Jimmy Key to Ruben Sierra. It's off his shoe tops. Golfs it out of there. Two-run home run. His third home run in the last 2 days. Meantime, Nolan Ryan has yet to allow the Jays a hit. It's 4-0 Texas now. 3 errors in the game for the Blue Jays already. Back to Gary and Dave.
John will keep us updated on yet another Nolan Ryan night.
And you and Mr. Ray Knight will have the Texas Rangers and Detroit Tigers Friday night, I do believe. And Ruben Sierra, there's talk of moving him to center field, but he can flat hit.
He sure can. And the breaking ball with a runner on at second base is in for his strike. Phillips singled and scored in the first. Eight-game hit streak for him. Average up now to 299 with his 1-for-2.
I think Inky will be going over to the Texas dugout to visit Bobby Valentine Friday.
It would be nice if that could happen someday again, but it certainly isn't going to happen right now. 0-1. Did he go? They checked. No, he didn't. We've seen Ted Hendry tonight at third base. John Hirschbeck's working the plate. Dave Phillips at first. Terry Cooney at second. And Hendry over at third. Tony Phillips, that's a lot of strikeouts for Bonica to have against Phillips, who does not strike out a lot. Pick off. Ooh, he almost had it blocked. He thought he did.
But Kurt Stillwell did everything he could to keep Fryman off the base. Bodied him, looked like a professional wrestler with the chest slam. This is a daylight play. It's a timing play. Boom. Boddicker, great quick move. And again, your chance to look. Is the foot in? Boy, it's close. Terry Cooney says safe. Can't really argue with it. It was a bang-bang play.
Stillwell had been jockeying with Fryman. Still is, trying to hold him close to the bag. The Tigers leading here 2-0, and the Royals not doing much offensively yet. They want to make sure that run at second base does not score. Tony Phillips trying to pick himself up an RBI. Said he did not strike out much. I look now at his totals this season. He's got him up there. He has struck out 13 times already this season. And he goes after that one and misses as Boniker pulls the string on him. Two balls and two strikes. Phillips last season struck out 85 times but drew 99 walks. Finished up with a .251 batting average. He was third in the league in base on balls. He has the eye. And the count is full. Three balls, two strikes, one out. Fryman on at second base. The Tigers leading 2-0, out hitting the Royals 4-3. The ball game mostly to the pitchers. Fryman at second base, not going to get off there until Boniker's ready to go to work. Everybody straight away on Phillips, the switch hitter. And Boniker got him. That was even softer. That's his second strikeout. And the 14th on the season for Phillips. Two down.
Boddicker has two changeups. One's a circle change, a conventional one. The other one he calls a fosh ball, which is kind of like a slow fork ball. You see Tony Phillips, he's all down in a crouch at the plate. And this ball is just going to come and never get there. Tony way out in front.
You know Sparky's talking about patience at the plate right there, even to Tony Phillips. Two down, the runner at second base. Trammell trying for the RBI here with two away. And misses inside. Last season, Alan Trammell, one of the best clutch hitters in the game. .379 with runners in scoring position. Third highest in the majors. And he takes the strike in the outside corner. He
rebounded after a very difficult 1989, not only for Trammell, but for the entire Tiger club. They lost 105 games. He had back problems a lot of the year, but he came back with a vengeance last year. And as Sparky Anderson says, sure first ballot Hall of Famer.
That one not too deep. McRae coming, will not have a play, and he's done it again. Trammell picks up the RBI on the two-out single. Fryman off and running on the crack of the bat scores after he led the inning off with a single. And it is now a 3-0 Tiger lead.
Well, every time Boddicker has made a mistake, somebody's gotten on base. The Tigers have cashed in. So the Tigers making the most of their opportunities. And when you're in a winning streak, that happens. And on the other side of the coin, when you're the Royals, you've lost four in a row. You just feel like every time a man gets on base, the opposition's going to find a way to score.
Trammell's 13th run batted in. So he has driven a run in and scored a run. Some real clutch hitting by the Detroit Tigers in this game. All of them have been clutch hits. Whitaker's two doubles for the RBI, and Trammell's single here in the fifth with two down. Their fifth hit, three runs and five hits. Whitaker. Boniker's about had enough of Lou Whitaker for the night.
Well, Dave Magadan of the Mets drove in 37% of men in scoring position last year, but Alan Trammell was with a rather select group tied for second, including Kelly Gruber. Trammell was in there, and Joe Carter.
Clutch hitting. Whitaker's batting 333. Trammell at first base, talking with Cromartie. Boniker with a 2-1. Whitaker couldn't stay off that one, and the count is two balls, two strikes. He turns around and wants to know whether that would have been a strike, John Hirschbeck telling him yes or no.
Once again, changeup. Whitaker way out in front. Boniker will throw over to first base. He's amongst the league leaders right now in that department, trying to keep his runners close and give McFarland a chance. Running situation. Trammell with 201 lifetime stolen bases. Started the year with 199, has two this year.
2-2, and he goes. Swung on and foul tipped. Well, Trammell will come back. And Whitaker keeps his at-bat alive. This is about the only area where these two players, Whitaker and Trammell, differed a whole lot at the plate last season. Trammell having a 380 plus average with runners in scoring position, while Whitaker hit just 219. It's kind of eerie. If you check these guys' numbers out for their careers, they are so close in virtually every category.
They came up together September 9th, 1977. And before last year, before the 1990 season, they both had 721 RBIs. Identical.
Runner goes and it hit him. The breaking ball by Boniker kept coming in, and Whitaker is hit by a pitch. Trammell at second, Whitaker at first, two out, and that's a big base runner because it brings up a big stick.
First 325 innings that Mike Boniker pitched in the major leagues, he did not hit a batter. Last year and the previous 2 years, the last 3 years, he and Dave Steve have been 1-2 in the American League and hit batters. None of these tonight. They've all been slow curves. They are not really intentional. He just doesn't have good control of the curveball tonight.
Fielder takes the breaking ball inside. That's the second hit batter by Boniker this season. Now Fielder, who has gone 0 for 2, but batting 284, has a chance to do real damage. Tigers leading 3-0. This is where Fielder is so dangerous. Two on, two out. And he cranks it into the gap in left center field. Trammell will score. Cut off by McRae. Coming to third, Whitaker. He'll try and score. Stillwell's relay is there. And they get him at the plate. Great relay throw to stop the inning. Run scores. 4-0 Tigers.
ESPN Major League Baseball is brought to you by Roundup. Say goodbye to hours of weeding. Nothing kills weeds better or easier than Roundup. By the Walker Advantage Muffler, the most advanced muffler you can buy. And by Franklin, the official batting glove of Major League Baseball.
Beautiful J.C. Nichols Fountain. That's in front of the Country Club Plaza, one of the oldest shopping areas in the country and the oldest one here, and it's gorgeous downtown Kansas City. Cecil Fielder getting the RBI, his 19th of the season. 4-0 now. And that one's tagged to deep left field, and it's fair, but it isn't. Whoa, McFarland ladled it. Strike one.
Boy, Mike was not going up there taking down 4-0. He whacked it. Is it live or is it memorized? Foul ball, says Ted Hendry, third base umpire. No argument from McFarland or Adrian Garrett, third base coach.
Hardest ball hit off Gullickson. And McFarland takes that one 1-1. Cecil Fielder now second in the league and runs batted in. Ripken 20 starting the day to lead the league. That one tagged again off the glove of Freiman into left field. Phillips in to get it, making the turn. McFarland, he'll stop. His club's down 4-0. Not going to take any chances getting thrown out. It is an error on Freiman.
You aren't used to playing on AstroTurf. That ball gets to you a lot quicker than you may think. And Travis just reached down, thought he had it in his sights, and the ball just ate him up. Reached, thought he had it, didn't. Tough error, though. Going to his left, short hop.
Fourth error on Freiman this season. So the Royals trying to get something going, get the leadoff man on. Second time in five innings they had the leadoff man on base. They were able to do it in the second, but Eisenreich was thrown out stealing after they were two down. Now Stillwell, the switch hitter. I'm not sure it makes a lot of difference at that part of the order, except who's hitting in front and behind you, which trying to give you something to hit or not. 4-0 lead for the Tigers. And that one is not going to be connected on. Strike two. Gullickson up.
Really tied him up with a great slider in on the hands. Most times, unless a switch hitter has great power, like a Tettleton and Eddie Murray, people like that, most of them kind of ping hitters. You try to throw the ball in on their hands.
32-year-old Gullickson. Looking for his third win of the season. And that one chopped foul by Stillwell. Holds the count at two strikes.
Mentioned earlier in the game, Gullickson was going almost exclusively with fastballs. Second pass through the order, starting to throw more breaking pitches. Three sliders in a row to Kurt Stillwell.
Those numbers are a continuation of career numbers for him. He's a .293 career hitter with runners on base. .222 when the bases are empty. 0-2. He's staying inside on. He misses there. One ball, two strikes.
Would figure naturally with a left-handed batter, at least Stillwell hitting from the left side most of the time, he's going to have that hole to hit through on the right side. Surprisingly, some guys have lower numbers with men on base. One guy is Fred McGriff of the San Diego Padres, a strong left-handed hitter, but he doesn't find that hole very much with a runner on.
Stillwell, who is a switch hitter, does better from the other side generally. And that one towards second base. Whitaker, Trammell had to hesitate. Good takeout at second base by McFarland to break up the double play. But they get the lead runner. Let's check in with John Saunders.
In the eighth in Cincinnati, the Pirates had tied the game. Then Randy Myers has Barry Bonds. But pure speed outraces it to the bag. And then Bobby Bonilla takes off. And he's home on the double steal. The Pirates now lead it 5-4 in the eighth inning. Get it back to Gary and Dave in Kansas City.
John, a couple of winners from last season. Those two clubs going at it again. Tigers lead here by a score of 4-0. Force play at second base on McFarland. Leaves Stillwell at first and Brian McRae. Foul that one off. Inside the park home run last night for him.
Indeed, indeed.
His dad had two here. Mike Swanson, our erstwhile statistician, called me to tell me today some numbers I could not believe. We're talking about what a ping-pong yard this is. They have had 153 inside the park home runs. I mean, that is, I'm sorry, 153. That one lined over the head of Whitaker. That's in the gap. That's going to go all the way to the wall. Stillwell at third makes the turn. Going for the triple, McRae standing up. 4-1, Tigers.
And the Tigers had not made many mistakes tonight, but the very reliable double play combination of Whitaker and Trammell botch a double play ball, and it cost him a run, could cost him another. Kyler tries to knock the ball down. I think even if he gets it, it's going to be a triple. Deer backs him up, but Brian McRae, with a great speed, goes all the way to third.
His first triple of the season, and he picks up the RBI. 4-1 ball game now. He's got to hope that's going to get him out of a slump that he has been in. Now Shumpert, who's batting 173, 0 for his last 8. And that misses.
This is where it's vital for Terry Shumpert to hit a ground ball up the middle or deliver the run. Fryman playing in at third. Cecil Fielder could come to the plate, but the Tigers are conceding the run at short and second. And a lot of times, guys can't even hit a ground ball in this situation. Shumpert needs to get his club back in the ballgame.
Only one away here. Talking about the inside the park homers, let me finish that. 53 inside the park home runs hit by the Royals here in this ballpark. Willie Wilson at 11 to lead them. That one left. Phillips tagging at third. Phillips the catch. There'll be no play. Sacrifice fly. Shumpert gets the run in, and it's 4-2.
Everything the Royals were doing was not good until that great relay turned it around. From McRae to Stillwell to McFarland, all of a sudden that seemed to give the Royals some fire. They've come in and scored two.
Great defensive plays will do that for you in any sport. Pick your play up. Two down now and the base is empty. Two runs on four hits for the Royals. McRae at RBI, his ninth of the season. And Shumpert getting the RBI, his sixth. Two away, bases empty, and Cromartie hitting 320.
Because of the error by Fryman, both the runs now unearned. That would have been the third out of the inning.
And the breaking ball by Gullickson is down. One ball, one strike. McFarland started it off with the error charged to Fryman at third base. He knows it. 1-1 towards second. And they're starting to get to Gullickson. So Cromartie is on his second hit. He's got a double and a single, two for three.
Well, Captain Hook probably thinking about getting his bullpen activated. Fifth inning is always tough. I don't care if you're one of the great veterans or just a rookie pitcher. You got a 4-0 lead. You know you got to get through the fifth to get that W, and all of a sudden, it won't be long before there'll be stirring down there.
Guys with their happy feet out there dancing away, waiting to see who gets the call. This season for Gullickson, he's gone six innings in his last outing, six and two-thirds in the two before that, and only three and a third in his first start.
Tigers got into the pen last night, but Paul Gibson did not pitch. He's rested, and Henneman, although he pitched two innings, only threw 16 pitches, so Sparky certainly could use him for an inning if needed, but he'd like to see Gullickson get at least six solid in.
All he needs is one more out here in the fifth inning. Those two runs picked up by the Tigers in the top of this inning loom very large right now. It's the difference in the ball game. Five hits for the Royals. Pecota looking for one himself. Takes the strike. 0-2.
Pecota, a guy who has been this organization, struggled a couple of years ago. He had three home runs in a doubleheader at Yankee Stadium. Had 15 total bases, a club record. That was on July 16th, and 2 weeks later, back to Omaha, Bill.
0-2 the count here. Leans over the plate. Gullickson teasing him right there. Ball and two strikes. Gullickson hasn't walked anybody. Has struck out one. Has given up five hits now. One, two. 2-2. Gullickson came in giving up more hits than innings pitched, 27 and 22 innings. Last season, he gave up 221 hits in 193 innings, but his ERA last year, 3.82, was very respectable. 2-2, no play in the suit.
So if you're going to give up a lot of hits, and one thing you can't do is walk people, and Gullickson very rarely walks people. So one or the other, you're going to get men on base. Gullickson does throw strikes. Billy Muffet, first phone call to the bullpen tonight. Unless he was calling out for pizza.
Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet. Here's the 2-2. Tyler. And that will do it. But a couple of unearned runs on two hits and an error. Well, the Tigers trying to sweep this three-game series with a 4-2 lead, and we've completed five. We are those two. Messieurs Thorne and Campbell, and delighted to have you with us. Dave will be on the West Coast Friday night. Ray Knight and I will be in Detroit. You've got California Angels and Baltimore Orioles.
Mr. Winfield and Mr. Ripken. Boy, Cal is off to a terrific start this year. But I wonder if Glenn Davis is out for any appreciable time. Ripken talks about, hey, you know, I'm getting good pitches to hit now. I do not have to expand my strike zone anymore, but that may change.
Mickey Tettelin leading it off. Like to get on base, 2-1. Did it a lot last year despite the strikeouts. Second in walks with 106. And second in strikeouts with 160. And he chops that guarding the line from Artie. He's got time and got him. Boddicker was waiting on the bag, and Cromartie playing a couple of steps off the line because it was hit so hard, had time to recover.
Well, he is on top of it. Game plan, probably to throw a lot of off-speed pitches to Tettleton. And Cromartie, with good defensive positioning, takes an extra base hit away from Mickey. You see Boddicker always under control. He is an excellent fielding pitcher. Gary told you at the top of the telecast, Gold Glove winner in the American League last year.
Get over there in a hurry. One away. Big curveball by Boddicker to Deer. Deer drew one of the two walks given up by Boddicker. Here's came in the fourth inning. The other came in the third to Trammell, and Trammell scored. RBI in the first. Whitaker's had two RBIs on two doubles. One in the first, one in the third. The other, the double by Fielder in the fifth. And then Trammell with the RBI in that same inning. 4-2 Tigers.
Well, Boddicker's fed Deer two pieces of heat in a row. What do you think? High fastball again, take him up the ladder, or the big arm motion and the sidearm slop, very slow curve. He's got Deer by the throat.
See what he does. 1-2, drop down, had him reaching. Stays alive on a protecting swing right there.
Deer stayed back pretty decently. He didn't jump out at the motion. That's the one thing, when Boddicker comes down, he throws that front elbow at you, and you just really want to stay back, but have trouble doing it.
Deer's up there in walks. He's eighth in the league, has 14 coming into the game. Has added one more to that.
What was that? That was the underhand riser.
Slot pitch. Two balls, two strikes, one out. Deer, who's sitting just 194, stays off that pitch, and it's full.
Bob's having a good at-bat. I mean, Boddicker turned him inside out with a couple of fastballs, but he's battled the count full now at 3-2.
Popped him up. Dakota over. Close. Closer, I think, than he thought it was going to be.
Yeah, I think Bill could have done a little bit of a jump job there if he realized it was coming back.
Poor baby. She's crying about the ball or the smoke.
Did it hit her on the arm? Come on, Bill. Going to make a better effort than that.
And a ball taken over. That'll elicit a little smile there. Huh? Come on. Not yet. 3-2 delivery again. And a broken bat. Fly ball. The barrel of the bat ends up at short. The ball ends up in Eisenreich's glove. And there are two down.
Heard a story recently about Hillrick and Bradley, who makes a lot of the bats. The Louisville Sluggers say that in about 10 years there will be no more white ash, which your bats are made out of. And if Rob Deer keeps doing that, they may run out in about 7 years. Does that mean we're going to have graphite or aluminum, or what are we going to have, folks?
I saw that story, too. And then I saw another story where the bat company said nonsense. But I'm not sure if that wasn't for economic reasons. I don't know. Well, if we're that bad in reforesting, we are in real trouble, which is probably fair to say.
Spotted,
two down.
Spotted owls.
Yeah. Incavelia. Quickly down on the count, 0-2. Boddicker trying to retire the side in order. He did that in the second inning. That's the only inning he's done that in. Detroit's left three on base, all in scoring position. They still have the 4-2 lead. And he's gone. See you later. Boddicker just did not mess around on that one. Incavelia retired. First time he has struck out tonight. 15th time on the season. Boddicker's got three Ks. National Hockey League playoffs going on. SportsCenter will have that along with all the baseball scores for you. Coming up after the ball game, and that's Tannable delivering a base hit. So the Royals continue to hit Gullickson. Couple of hits in the last inning, and they lead this one off with a single here in the sixth inning. Gibson coming up, so is John Saunders.
Well, hits is something that the Blue Jays are not getting against Nolan Ryan here, striking out Glenn Allen Hill. This was his ninth strikeout of the night. He now has since added another 10 strikeouts on the night for Nolan Ryan. 209th time he's done that in his career. Let's get back to Gary and Dave.
John will keep us updated on that. Billy's on the phone again.
It's up tough. Never know now.
Gibson up and throwing in the bullpen, and Kurt Gibson up at the plate. Gullickson, a runner at first. Gibson represents the potential tying run now in this 4-2 Tiger lead game.
One of the things we were talking to Sparky Anderson about before the game, I said, Sparky, you've always kind of had the nickname Captain Hook, but I said, in fairness to you, you've never really had a horse with the exception of Don Gullett in Cincinnati and Jack Morris with the Tigers. He says, you're right. And he says, what a blessing Morris was for 10 years, giving me that eight innings. He said, I could plan to rest my bullpen, but this Tiger staff this year doesn't have a horse that they can really count on to give them that 7 and 8 innings every time out.
They do not. They are relying on their bullpen. The bullpen has come through for them. The 0-1 to Gibson is a strike on the outside corner. Tigers are fourth overall in ERA. Look at the pens done for them.
3.2 innings pitched per game. Right now he's with a four-man rotation as Dan Petrie's been back in the pen. He had a bit of a back spasm, so I don't care how deep you are, you're going to have to get a little better work out of the starters or that pen's going to have some trouble come July and August.
That's a lot of work. 0-2 the count on Gibson. And he nailed him on a high inside fastball. So Gullickson strikes out Gibson. It's just his second strikeout of the game. And he really set him up.
Gully really reached back, 87 miles an hour. Second best fastball he's throwing tonight, and he just tied Kirk up in knots. Good pitchers know when to reach back and get that little extra, and Gullickson, a professional pitcher who's been around, he really aired out a fastball to Gibson.
Gibson has struck out 15 times this season. That's an important one right there. Here's Eisen right now, batting 324, and Jim fouls it back. He continued his hit streak at 10 games with a single in the second inning.
Boy, Eisenreich was right on that breaking ball.
Kansas City Royals, 10th in average coming into this game, way up there in strikeouts. Only 9 home runs. They're not going to hit home runs largely because of this home park. Not a lot of runs scored thus far this season. They've only picked up 72 runs this year, which is down near the bottom of the stack in the American League. They're only down by 2. That one's in the dirt. Good block made by Tuttle. Detroit Tigers, I look at their numbers, Dave, and it still amazes me. The club's last in hitting in the league, yet their 97 runs is right up there at the top in runs scored. They are truly that club that defies logic.
I don't think it matters how you get them. I mean, if you're going to hit a lot of home runs, last year the Tigers led the American League with 750 runs, but their pitching was 14th and last in ERA. If they get the good pitching this year, they're going to be better.
And that one slapped to second base. Whitaker will go to first and get the second out on Eisenreich as Tartable ends up at second base with two down.
Good veteran play by Whitaker. He had the outside shot at getting the force at second, but you want to go one out at a time when you have a two-run lead, and it really was an iffy play. You got to make the full spin to get the ball to Trammell. You may hit the runner going in, but Whitaker made the right play and just went to first base.
Billy Muffet is on his way out to the mound with McFarland coming up. McFarland hit a ball as hard as we've seen against Gullickson tonight, but it was a long foul ball down the left field line. Muffet may want to remind Gullickson about that.
I think maybe what they're talking about is get the ball on the outside part of the plate. McFarland's very quick inside during this good streak right now, and he's seen the ball in very well. I think Gullickson will work him away, make him hit it to center field if he's going to do any damage.
Farland had 6 home runs last season, has not picked up a home run yet this season. Came that close, but he's having a fine offensive start, batting 328, hit 255 last year. And that's just what he does. Davey stays away, ball one.
He's got an open base. Stillwell, not a big power hitter on deck, but when you only have a two-run lead, you hate to put the tying run on. So I think Gully's going to go after him, but he wants to make him hit the ball straight away.
McFarland, the sixth best average in the league starting the day. And he tags it to left again. Phillips, who is deep, will play it on a hop. That'll score a run. Carnival makes this a one-run ball game on McFarland's RBI single. Yet another two-out hit here tonight.
Well, the ball looked like it was away. McFarland just went out and raked it. He broke his bat, but the Tigers got a run on a bloop single by Alan Trammell, so the Royals probably figure they're even. Let's see the location of the pitch. It's on the outer half of the plate, but not as far out as Sparky Anderson or Billy Muffet would have liked to have seen it. And that's going to be it for Mr. Gullickson as Billy Muffet takes the long stroll.
So that'll do it as the Kansas City Royals have battled back from the deficit to make it a one-run game. Well, Gullickson is gone, but has a 4-3 lead at least for the moment. Paul Gibson coming on in relief to try and protect it. Turning point in this game, Dave Campbell?
Really was a great relay play that the Royals executed, driving to left center field off the bat of Cecil Fielder, and Brian McRae went over, made a backhanded stab, got the ball to Stillwell, threw to the plate, was perfect, and it was just the kind of play that can turn things around for a club that's lost four games in a row.
Sure did seem to fire them up, I'll tell you. And now we'll see whether or not this Detroit bullpen can hang on against the Royals, being called on to do it after the starter Gullickson works 5 2/3. Seven hits off him, no walks, couple of strikeouts. Three runs, of course, charged to him. Two of those runs unearned, and he's responsible for McFarland is on at first base.
We were talking to Sparky Anderson about the computer age, and I said, Sparky, do you use those things? He says, nah. He says, if I don't know it after being here all these years. Well, Sparky knows. Kurt Stillwell last year hit .231 batting right-handed, .258 left-handed. The other thing is, Kurt Stillwell's from Thousand Oaks, California, which happens to be Sparky's hometown. He knows that Stillwell's a better hitter left-handed, so he's going to turn around and make him bat right-handed. You don't need computers all the time to figure those things out.
You better check this year's numbers, because Stillwell's hitting .353.
Yeah, but Sparky's going on past performance. Past performance only.
All right, past performance. Let's see if it holds up. Two down, runner at first base. Stillwell takes the breaking ball from the 31-year-old left-hander, Paul Gibson. Inside for a ball. Switch hitters turned around. He scored a run in the fifth inning after reaching on a fielder's choice. Two unearned runs in the fifth for Kansas City on the initial error that allowed the leadoff man McFarland to get on. He's on again at first base. 1-1.
Sparky said Paul Gibson may get 130 innings pitched this year out of the bullpen. Last year, he pitched 97. That was the fourth most coming out of the bullpen in the American League. So this is a workhorse. His job is to try to get it to the ninth inning and then turn it over to Mike Henneman. We mentioned Henneman pitched two innings yesterday, but only threw 16 pitches, so he would be available tonight.
Two down, the 1-1 delivery to him, a breaking ball in, one ball, two strikes. Gibson has been murder on right-handed hitters thus far this season. They are 5-for-34 off him. That's a .147 batting average off Paul Gibson.
Gibson reminds me a little bit, and I say a little bit, of a great left-handed relief pitcher by the name of Ron Peronowski, who could throw the curveball at any time in the count and get it over for strikes.
4-3 Tiger lead. And he got him to pop up. Shortstop Trammell backing up. He wants it. And he puts it away. So Gibson does preserve it. Gullickson, who left the game, has a chance to be the winner. Boddicker, the starter. Two walks, three strikeouts. Tigers have four runs, six hits off him. And he'll face Fryman. We'll lead it off here. He led off the fifth inning with a single and scored. His 1-for-2, getting out of an 0-for-14 with that single and batting now at .203 as he crosses that 200 line, which you never want to fall under. 1-0. Look at the knees buckle. 1-1. Fryman, a couple of home runs, one triple, one double. He's getting some extra base hits. Takes that inside, two balls, one strike.
Never know it by the serious look on Mike Boddicker, but this is one of the great practical jokers in baseball. He has a terrific sense of humor. He put poor Kevin Apier in a fit the other day.
jumped on the high one, but Cota gets it there in time. Let's check in with John Saunders.
Time now for Miller Beer's Streaks, Peaks, and Valleys. Streaks, look at the Mariners. Six losses to start the year. They won eight in a row. That tied a club record. You see the rest. And right now, they're trying for their third in a row. They lead the Orioles 1-0 in the sixth. Peaks, Ricky Henderson, number 939, passing Lou Brock on the all-time list. And Valleys, the San Diego pitching staff, 22 runs in their last 22 innings pitched. That's over three games. Nolan Ryan has struck out 12 and has a no-hitter in the seventh. Make it 13 now. We'll keep you updated. Back to Gary and Dave.
Perfect bunt. No way that's going to be played. And Kyler is on. He just dragged that down the line, deadened it almost halfway between home and first base. And Kyler's on with one out here in the seventh inning.
Well, we mentioned Boddicker, a Gold Glove winner. He bounces off the mound, but this ball just hits, and if it's possible to get backspin on it, he did. And Boddicker can do nothing but look at it. Kind of hoped it would roll foul, but it was not going to. Mentioned Boddicker. The other day he was wrestling with Kevin Apier, and all of a sudden he went, oh, my neck! Goes into the clubhouse, gets a neck brace on, comes out, gets a writer involved, doing an interview about how he hurt his neck. Apier standing in the outfield, just crushed.
McRae in front of it. And Phillips is retired for the second out of the inning. Two down. Kyler goes back to first base.
Is this getaway night or something for these two
this
teams?
This is getaway night. Wow. They've played two long games with rain delays and everything else, and they are first ball hitting no matter what. Yeah, Apier was scared. He thought Boddicker was really hurt. He got the trainer involved. The trainer helped him put on the brace around his neck, and they both came out serious-faced. Apier thought he was going back to A-ball.
Yeah, last year, Boddicker on April Fool's Day called his father-in-law and said he had been traded from the Red Sox to the Milwaukee Brewers to get closer to home. And then the father-in-law found out later it was April Fool's joke. And his father-in-law says, I'm going to put a curse on you. He went out the first time he pitched against the Milwaukee Brewers. It was Patriots Day in Boston last year, and the Brewers won 18-0.
Oh, my gosh.
And he's been asking his father-in-law to please take the curse off.
Don't fool with your father. Two down here. Each team has seven hits in the game. Kyler's on at first base with great speed. Trammell wasn't even ready in the on-deck circle. That's why he was still in the dugout. I think he thought for sure Phillips would wait a while with Kyler on at first base with that speed, but he didn't do it. Pen is active. Crawford and Magnotti. Two down here.
Trammell just had an earpiece in and figured we were trying to get a story in, and these guys were first pitch hitting, so he gave us a break. And that's a guy who wants to be a broadcaster when he gets done.
Yeah, that's it. He's batting 303. Far from done. Takes the strike. RBI in the fifth inning for him. Scored a run after he walked in the third. He and Whitaker, shortstop combination, have been nothing but deathly trouble for Boddicker. Whitaker's delivered the two RBIs. Trammell one and two runs scored. 0-1 the count. Kyler, pretty good lead. There he goes. Breaking ball. Throw down. Not in time. No way McFarland was going to get him.
Well, even with a slide step, Boddicker threw the ultra-slow curveball, and McFarland no shot whatsoever. Kyler, who stole 50 in A-ball a couple of years ago, gets a great break, and then the slow curve. No chance for McFarland at all.
4-for-5 for Kyler in stolen bases.
So,
and it puts him in scoring position.
Milks made his presence felt tonight. Fine running catch in center field. Sacrifice bunt to set up a run on a stolen base there.
That one pushed to center. McRae will put it away.
Except Kyler forgot how many outs there were.
He ran back a second. Seventh inning stretch time from Kansas City. One run ball game.
And Major League Baseball is brought to you by Bud Dry. Why ask why? Try Bud Dry for a refreshment that's beyond question. By Wagner, power painting that's not just a whole lot faster, but a whole lot better. And by Kmart, where you'll always find the quality you need at the price you want.
Gary Thorne, Dave Campbell with you here in Kansas City. Great to have you with us at Royal Stadium on ESPN's Wednesday night baseball game. And a good one. 4-3, Tigers are leading. They have led throughout. Kansas City, though, has burned their way back into this game after trailing 4-0. Each team seven hits. Bottom of the seventh inning. Paul Gibson's on for Gullickson, and he's facing McRae, who tripled, driving in a run in the fifth. And we're seeing him for the first time in this game bat right-handed. McRae this season as a switch hitter. 1-for-11 from the right side. But he's ahead on the count here, 3-0.
Not the guy you want to put on base to lead off an inning in a one-run game.
Number 8 hitter. And Gibson doesn't even come close. So McRae is on, and the potential tying run is now at first base with nobody out in the seventh inning. John Saunders.
The Nolan watch continues. Here facing Kelly Gruber for strikeout number 13, and he is now through seven innings. We will take you to Texas for the eighth inning and ninth inning as Nolan Ryan tries to nail down another no-hitter. Right now, let's take it back. Gary and Dave.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable man. Thank you, John. Nobody out here. The speedster on at first base, Brian McRae. Shumpert at the plate. Everybody looking for the bunt. Fryman's charging in from third. Cecil Fielder playing a step off the bag towards the plate at first. Shumpert hitting just 173. So Gibson's going to work at first base to keep McRae as close as he can.
Doesn't that man know he's 44 years old?
No.
That ball looked like it sailed a foot. A sailing fastball at 97 miles an hour. Now that's just flat, no fair. Kelly Gruber looked like, wow.
So close, so often, and so many. The half dozen. Nolan Ryan. We'll keep you posted. One strike count. You see Fryman moving in at third base. Short and second double play depth. Fielder the step off the bag at first. Shumpert trying to get it down the first baseline. Lets that go. One ball and one strike. Both charging first and third. Adrian Garrett going through the signs for Shumpert. Shumpert has one sacrifice coming into the game. The added sacrifice fly in the fifth inning. Now trying to get it down. Does not. There's a big mistake. Tettleton puts it away. One away. You don't want to go back to the dugout after those.
Well, a lot of times when managers see the sacrifice bunt go awry, then they decide to put a hit and run on. For Marty up against Gibson, tough left-hander. But Wathan may want to get Brian McRae in gear at first base, and Shumpert walks down the alleyway.
This wants to disappear. Now Cromartie will face the left-hander. He's done a little of that this season. Only two at-bats against lefties. He's 0 for 2. Cromartie, the left-handed hitter, trying to move McRae around here in the bottom of the seventh inning with the Tigers leading 4-3, and Gibson trying to hold the lead. Cromartie's got that hole between first and second with Fielder holding the bag.
Wheels turning. Close ball games. The first six innings belong to the players. Last three belong to the managers. The wheels are turning. Sparky Anderson anticipating hit and run. Wathan thinking, hey, how good a move does Gibson have to first? Was that his best?
McRae trying to get the read on the pitcher here, Gibson.
So far, McRae has not tipped anything off, so if he is going, he is not showing that. A lot of times you throw over to first base to see if you can get a read on the runner. Sparky eyeballing McRae right now to see if he's making any kind of a false break. Roger Craig of the San Francisco Giants, so good at that, but remember, he was the pitching coach for Sparky Anderson for a number of years in Detroit. Those guys have eagle eyes on that bench.
Gibson drawing some boos from the home crowd by throwing over to first. Cromartie waiting. Popped him up. No play. On the top of the dugout. Tuttleton almost embarrassed on that one. He did not break to go after the ball. That almost came down where he could have caught it.
Didn't see it. Gibson, to his credit, broke off the mound. And yeah, I have seen pitchers make catches in foul territory. They spot the catcher not seeing the ball, they bust off the hill. But that ball was not in the air long enough.
Gibson had a couple of pickoffs last season, so McRae will have to be careful at first base. Cromartie, 0-1. One away. And the 18,000-plus fans on hand here at Royal Stadium trying to kick it in for the Royals. Cromartie watches that go high, 1-1.
Gibson also going with the slide step, so if Brian McRae is going to steal, he's going to have to do it off Tuttleton because Gibson's getting the ball to Mickey in a hurry. Tuttleton's throwing well this year. Got a man tonight. He's 6 out of 14.
Last season, base runners had the fourth best average against Tuttleton in the league for success rate against catchers. That one's taken for the strike. How much of that you put on the pitchers, you just have to know each individual staff.
Well, that Baltimore staff, of course, Dave Johnson, nobody ever steals on him, but a guy like Ben McDonald, high leg kick, Greg Olson coming out of the bullpen, easy to steal on.
Gibson ahead on the count, a ball, two strikes. McRae at first. He got jammed. You can tell Cromartie's not real comfortable seeing the left-handers. He just doesn't have enough at-bats against the left-handers.
Well, I'm sure John Wathen had to think about the situation of using Russ Moorman, a big, strong outfielder first baseman in this particular spot. But he elected to stay with Cromartie, who's been swinging a good bat lately, Warren 2-for-3. Not a lot of bench strength over there for John Wathen, particularly from the right side tonight.
Lineup card posted right behind him there on the yellow clipboard. Again, the throw to first.
Paul Zavella, light hitting infielder. Gary Thurman, a contact type hitter, no power. David Howard, a switch hitter, not too much power. So Russ Moorman, the only legitimate threat he has over there.
Dakota, the on-deck batter. 1-2 delivery, Cromartie. And Gibson's missing. He's really missing. And it's two balls, two strikes.
Now Gibson really tried to reach back, and he must be thinking that Cromartie's sitting on breaking ball because Warren has been late on the fastball, and Billy Muffet's going to have come out and have a little talk. Last time Muffet came out, it didn't work out as McFarland poked a single to left off Gullickson, and that was it for Bill.
Gibson, the setup man, will talk with his pitching coach here. Tuttleton coming up to join in. Don't forget our Sunday Night Baseball here on ESPN. 8 o'clock Sunday night. It'll be the Yankees and the Mariners. Don Mattingly and not only Griffey Jr., but Griffey Sr. Both of them putting some numbers up this season and back-to-back a lot in the batting order. So you'll see it Sunday right here on ESPN, our Sunday Night Baseball. Tiger bullpen waiting. Nobody's up to throw.
Tigers have an off day tomorrow, so nobody will be spared tonight. But again, with Mike Henneman working two innings last night, I know Sparky wants to try to nurse Gibson through the eighth.
Two balls, two strikes, one out. Runner at first, 4-3 Tigers. And Cromartie punches it to left field. Phillips hauls it in, and there are two down. So that battle between Cromartie and Gibson is won by Gibson. Now there are two away in the seventh inning, and it'll bring up Percota.
Percota, one of those guys who is just bound to determine he's going to get his 4 years to get on that pension. But he's been up and down that freeway between Omaha and Kansas City for about the last 7 years. But an organizational type guy, he does what the club asks him. And when Kevin Seitzer went down with the injury, Percota has the shot at third base now.
What's his nickname? I-70. 29. Wrong way.
Yeah. I-70 was the 85
series. That was the 85 series, yeah. Want to go to Omaha, not St. Louis.
Florida was out at first.
Yeah, that's right. Two down here. 1-0 count. And a center. Tyler's got plenty of room for this one, and that'll do it. So Gibson gave up a leadoff walk and got away with it here in the seventh inning. Seven complete. Tigers up by one. Thank you, John. And Mickey Tuttle and me congratulated. He just belted his third home run of the season, picking up two RBIs as Boniker gives up his third long ball. And the Tigers have upped their lead to 6-3. Whitaker led off the inning with a walk, the third given up by Boniker. Fielder struck out, and then Tuttle put one down the right field line just inside the foul pole. Two RBI home run. That's the eighth hit off Boniker, and it is a 6-3 Tiger lead with Rob Deere standing in. So, the Detroit Tigers, long balls there, middle name.
Well, Tettleton crushed one in New York last week, and he hits this ball three quarters of the way up in the bleachers and just barely fair, but he got all of it.
They've had a home run, at least one, in the last six consecutive games. They've got 23 home runs on the season, leading the league in homers. And that's fouled off. They are on a pace right now to hit 198 home runs as a team if they kept the pace up they're on right now.
I think the bubble burst a little bit on Boniker. He's like a basketball player, reaching over, grabbing his knees. He's winded. Probably the telling tale was the leadoff walk to Whitaker, but John Wathen wanted to give him a chance to win the ball game. He kept his club close after falling behind 4-0, but it hurt.
And Deere gets around on that, too far around, and fouls it off. He had the green light on 3-1. Now it's 3-2.
Yeah, I think Boniker better go to something slow here because Rob Deere's got that fastball zeroed in pretty well.
3-2 delivery with one away and the bases empty. Missed inside and he walked it. That may be it. That's four walks now given up by Boniker, and John Wathen is on his way out. Two walks this inning. As Dave said, Boniker simply tired. And it may have cost the Royals a ball game with that home run that he gave up. So Boniker's gone, four strikeouts and four walks, but he's charged right now with the six runs on eight hits that the Tigers have with a three-run lead. Storyline here in Kansas City tonight. Detroit, their big boppers getting it done. 5-for-9, four RBIs. Tuttle had that two-run homer. And Boniker, 121 pitches is gone. And right-hander, 32-year-old Steve Crawford on the mound now. Runner goes inside Incavelia. And we may have an interference at the plate. Nope.
Well, John Watson's going to come out. Well, this is the second time it's happened in a week. In this case, Incavia is trying to avoid the pitch, and that may be the one saving grace for John Hirschbeck, the home plate umpire. But earlier in the week, McFarland figured he was interfered by Tony Phillips of the Tigers and didn't get the call. And McFarland talking to Hirschbeck about whether there was batter interference or not.
I thought there was, and I thought Hirschbeck was going to give it a call. He came up from behind home plate as though he was going to make the call, but you're right, Dave. Incavelia did a real good dance as though he was off balance.
Rule of thumb is it does not have to be intentional, but in this case, Hirschbeck figured that Incavelia was trying to avoid the pitch, turned into kind of a pretzel over home plate. So it's a judgment call by the umpire there. You can see McFarland double clutch and can't follow through properly. But Watson wants a call and is not going to get it.
Rob Deere will be credited with his first stolen base. And while Incavelia will never admit it, I really think he figured out what was going on after he had stepped back and did a very smart thing by taking an extra step on the plate.
Deere just asked Terry Shumpert, you think Ricky's worried about me? Of course, if you missed it, Ricky Henderson this afternoon picked up the stolen base number 939. You see, Incavelia. And right there, I don't know. It's just a matter of whether he was on balance or not. It doesn't have to be intentional, but in that case, Hirschbeck said Incavelia was getting out of the way of the pitch, and that caused him to fall over the plate.
So it puts the runner at second, Deere with a stolen base, with one away, and Incavelia chance for the RBI. Pops it up. Carlin coming back will not have a play. Two runs in here in the eighth inning on the two-run homer by Tuttleton. Steve Crawford. Not a lot of work thus far.
non-roster player, made the club. Red Sox fans certainly remember Steve from the 86 playoffs. Also got a win in the World Series. But Crawford was on the mound. Looked like the Angels were going to win it all. Doug DeCinci at the plate. One out, bottom of the ninth inning, tie game. But DeCinci hit a fly ball out. Crawford got out of it, and the Red Sox went on to win that and the playoffs.
One ball, one strike, and one away. And Incavilla on the breaking ball is fooled. A ball and two strikes.
Yeah, on Monday night, Travis Fryman was trying to steal a base and kind of liked that play. And McFarland ended up hurting his arm. Thought that Tony Phillips interfered with him. Didn't get a call then. Didn't get the call tonight.
And McFarland is throwing so well, he doesn't want to put any whammy on that arm because he's getting people out. Last season, he really struggled. Bay Steelers had the best success rate against him of any catcher in the league. Detroit leading here, 6-3, bottom of the eighth inning. We'll keep you posted on Nolan Ryan's no-hitter. Of course, when he goes back to the mound, we'll take you back there. Crawford gets the strikeout, and there are two away.
John Watson, a former catcher, defended McFarland and said it was not his fault. Our pitchers did not give him a chance. And quite frankly, Crawford never gave him a chance on that one. Deer was off, had a huge jump at first base.
So Fryman will try and deliver. His single in the fifth resulted in a run scored. He's batting an even 200 right now. Has Deer at second and two away. And he got out on that one, fouls it off. The Tigers win. They will have swept the series three games. They haven't had a sweep here in Kansas City since 1984. And that really hurts you when you get swept at home. Doesn't sit well at all. Here are the Tigers, though, and you can pick up a sweep on the road and feel very good about yourself. 0-1 delivery in the dirt. McFarland blocks it, holds Deer at second. Very quiet Kansas City dugout, because if they lose here, it's going to be five in a row. And they are in the midst of a big homestand, 10 games in 10 days. Crawford trying to get the final out. One ball, one strike, 6-3 Tiger lead. Fryman starts, tipped into the mitt, 1-2.
Tigers swept the Royals in the playoffs in 1984 as well on their way to the world title. What a year for Detroit. 35-5 was their start. Never headed the rest of the way.
I'm going to take you back to Nolan Ryan's no-hitter here in just a moment. One ball, two strikes, two outs. Crawford. Fryman takes it outside. Tigers are leading by a score of 6-3. John?
All right. You know the story. It's going into the ninth inning. Nolan Ryan trying for his seventh career no-hitter. And his second in less than a year. So right now, let's take you out to Texas and join Don Chevrier and Tommy Hutton for the ninth.
Not just the eyes of Texas, but the eyes of North America are upon Nolan Ryan here in the ninth inning, looking for a career seventh no-hitter at the age of 44. First up, shortstop Manuel Lee. Low ball one. Just two base runners. Carter in the seventh inning. Gruber in the first on walks. On wide. Roberto Alomar, top of the order, due next for Toronto.
Two hit by Mark Whitten, one in the fifth inning, a fly ball to deep center, a line drive to right field in the eighth, and then that shallow fly ball by Manuel Lee in the sixth inning that Gary Pettis raced in and made a fine catch.
Devon White has a hat trick tonight. Three strikeouts. There have been three no-hitters in this state. Leading back to 1906, ball one to White. 15 strikeouts for Ryan this night. White fouls that back, 1-1. hitting with a 1-for-25 lifetime mark versus Ryan.
Devon White, 3 strikeouts, came into the game 1-for-22 lifetime against Nolan.
White prolongs it just a little bit longer.
About it, the last couple of innings, thinking back to that one curveball that Glenn Allen Hill back in the eighth inning had a good rip at, about that time Nolan really hasn't had the control of the curveball that he did through the first 6 or 7 innings. Even that one there had sharp break to it, but was out of the strike zone. Again, I think he's going to stay upstairs with his fastball.
Just missed outside with it, 3-2. Goes to a full count for the 7th time tonight. Franco again. Ryan's an out away. And now the only man standing between Nolan Ryan, the 7th career no-hitter, is Toronto's second baseman, Roberto Alomar.
And even though Roberto Alomar is a fine bunter, you go up there and you say to yourself, if you're going to break up a no-hitter, you're going to do it swinging.
You've got to. Like everybody else tonight, he's 0-for-3, and that's strike one.
This is electrifying, and I know after he struck out the side in the second inning, you and I turned and looked at each other and said, he is on his A game tonight.
You had that feeling. Strike two. Perhaps the most remarkable man to pitch in this game, Nolan Ryan. Low. This entire stadium standing in anticipation of the final strike or the final out.
He's staying with his fastball.
It is what has gotten him this far, and he hopes it'll drive him home. Two and two.
Nolan looking at that ball saying, I don't want this. No more curveballs. Give me a good one. I'm going to go with the heat.
Nope, that won't do either. Let's settle for this one. stubborn young hitter hangs in with it.
You have that right. Give some credit to Roberto Alomar, who battles and battles and battles right here. He doesn't want to make the last out.
Young man who got his first big league hit ever off Nolan Ryan. That's it! Number seven is in the books. The remarkable Ryan has done it again.
We talked about early on he had the exceptional curveball as well as his always fastball that's there, but he got away from the curveball because he wasn't throwing it as well for strikes. Just an incredible performance, not only gave people here chills, I have them myself.
Oh, everybody in this park has. You had to be thrilled just watching at those final pitches and the battle with the game young hitter Alomar. You wondered if the 44-year-old was going to tire finally, make one bad pitch to end it all in a negative way, but no, he hung in right to the end and got what he came for. So Fergie is there with him. We're going to be able to go to him in just a moment or two to capture the thoughts of the man of the hour in baseball, Nolan Ryan. Maybe the man of this century in terms of pitching.
The amazing thing, too, Chevy, is that back in the early 70s, the no-hitter he pitched against Detroit, he had 17 strikeouts and 16 he had tonight. That's the second best figure in that strikeout mark for Nolan Ryan in his seven no-hitters.
So you see, in the first no-hitter of the season of 1991, in the fifth start for Nolan Ryan. And he comes out once again to acknowledge his crowd here, his faithful in Arlington, Texas. Many leaving, they're standing to relish and cherish this moment with Nolan.
Nolan Ryan with his record seventh no-hitter and the second you've seen here on ESPN in the last year. Got his sixth last year against the Oakland A's. And here's a look at the other six no-hitters of Nolan Ryan. As I said, against Oakland A's on June 11th, 1990. Interesting note here. Got his first no-hitter at age 26. Got a pair that year, just a couple of months apart. And over an 18-year span, he has recorded the seven no-hitters, with the most recent tonight, 12 one-hitters to go with that as well. Nolan Ryan, we hope to hear from him momentarily. Of course, we will have baseball tonight and SportsCenter following the game you're watching, Kansas City against Detroit. That's the game most of you were watching. The rest of you will go to Major League Baseball Magazine. But still, plenty more to come. Keep it right here on ESPN's Wednesday Night Baseball as we take a look at Nolan Ryan nailing down his seventh no-hitter. Roberto Alomar worked him tough, but with two strikes against him, Nolan Ryan already with 15 strikeouts in the game.
He just brings it, just as tough as he did in the first inning. And the strikeout, number 16 and number 7 no-hitter.
Ryan has done it again.
Thorne and Dave Campbell back with you in Kansas City. There you see the score. Tigers are leading it by a score of 6-4. There is Danny Tarnable, who leading off the eighth inning, hit his second home run. It came off Paul Gibson to make it a 6-4 ball game. We'll bring you up to date here. Crawford is working. Kyler is on the mound. This is Tarnable's home run.
Ball's going to hit the top of the fence and bounce over. And also keep an eye on Rob Deere on this play. I think he ends up spraining a wrist. He stayed in the game, but came off and was not feeling too well.
Played at first, and that'll take care of Kyler as Cromartie plays the ground ball unassisted. Top of the ninth inning.
The left fielder.
Six runs, eight hits, an error for the Tigers. The Royals, four runs, eight hits, and no errors. Boddicker works 7 1/3. Pitcher of record, giving up six runs on eight hits, including the two-run homer to Mickey Tuttle, which right now is the difference in this game. Gullickson making the start on the other side. Went 5 2/3 for the Tigers. He's got a chance to win it. Three runs, only one earned on seven hits. Gibson worked two innings, a run on a hit, the home run by Tarnable. And then Henneman is on for the Tigers. And Crawford working. And that one's fouled off, Crawford, by Phillips.
Question of the evening for headline sports writers tomorrow. Ricky Henderson, Nolan Ryan. Both.
Put them both. Just put them both. All the stories on Henderson have already been written since he got his stolen base mark this afternoon. What a story, though, for Nolan Ryan. The incredible performances special. Continue, huh? Yeah. 0-1 pitch on the outside corner for a strike, 0-2.
I mean, he's not doing it against the weak sisters. I mean, he gets the Toronto Blue Jays this year, the Oakland A's last year. I mean, this guy is just phenomenal.
When he is on with that fastball in the strike zone and he's throwing the changeup and curveball as he was tonight, just forget it. 0-2, one down. Tigers trying to sweep the three-game series here in the ninth inning. Kansas City will get a final shot at it. They will have scheduled up the bottom third of their order. Phillips waiting. Crawford's pitch is down low. One ball, two strikes. It's been a good ball game. Kansas City has trailed throughout, though. The Tigers getting a run in the first, one in the third, two more in the fifth to make it 4-0. Royals made it 4-2 with two in the bottom of the fifth. Added to it in the sixth inning, cut it to a one-run game. But Tettelin's two-run homer in the eighth inning upped at 6-3. And then Tarnable with a home run in the bottom of the eighth to make it 6-4. Each team with eight hits. Crawford's away. Two balls, two strikes.
See, trying to get the good feel of the seams, rotating that ball behind his back. Evidently didn't get it to his liking on that delivery.
There you see Mickey Tettelin still with the catcher's gear on and a lot to smile about. Home run number 3 that came in the eighth inning. Boddicker has given up 3 on the year. That was costly. Here's the 2-2, and he went around on that one. And Phillips is not going to argue. He's a strikeout victim. Two strikeouts for Crawford, and there are two down in the ninth. This copyrighted telecast presented by Authority of Major League Baseball may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form without the express written consent of Major League Baseball. Two down, bases empty in the ninth.
Nolan said he was going to be making a decision fairly soon about next year. think that helped?
Made it.
Oh, my.
Mercy, mercy. And a man who has, through all of it, has not changed an iota. He's a Texas farmer. Where the roots are, and that's where they still are, with the family on the farm.
I keep hearing there are no heroes left. Wrong.
Yeah. But if you want to model your life, or have your children's lives modeled after someone, that's not a bad icon to take a look at. One ball, one strike. Breaking ball on the inside corner by Crawford makes it 1-2.
What's the current count? 9 or 10 teammates or former teammates have named their sons Ryan?
Yeah. That tells you a whole lot about the people who know him the best. Would think that highly of him. One ball, two strikes on Trammell, who's hitting 299, and he takes that one away. Sports Illustrated, I thought, had an outstanding
terrific. A couple of weeks back,
a baseball issue. If you haven't seen that, it's worthwhile picking up with the no-hitter. Sports Illustrated will probably put it out again on the stands, but it was an outstanding story. I wish I could. I thought it was Lee Montville who wrote it, but I'm not sure. I think it was. 2-2 delivery. And that's tagged to center field. McRae got a bad break. Started late, falls in front of him. And Trammell is on. That's his second hit. He's been on three of the five plate appearances with two singles and a walk. Has an RBI and has scored a run. That's hit number nine for the Tigers.
He would figure he would pick one of his closest friends, a former teammate who was kind of a role player, Harry Spillman, who lives right next door. In fact, Harry's wife is Nolan's secretary. Just a great story about the two of them, about the Ryan family, and they're still our heroes left, folks.
Yeah. Warming up in Cowfield, throwing baseballs before to camp.
I loved it.
Can you imagine that? Whitaker's had a big night. He's batting 333, 10 RBIs on the season now, two of them in this game, and his first two at-bats with the two doubles. As he continues to rake Mike Boniker.
You know, nobody has ever gone into the Hall of Fame unanimously on the first ballot. Nowhere in the annals of baseball history. You think he may be the first?
No, because I think the writers have decided nobody's going to be in unanimously.
They said if Babe can't do it?
Nobody can. Yeah, I suspect that. I don't think it has anything to do with Nolan Ryan. 2-0 count, two down. Tigers are leading 6-4. Whitaker with Trammell on at first base. Crawford to him. Outside corner, two balls and one strike. Sports Center coming up right after our game tonight, and there's lots to talk about. How about the headlines? Ricky's going to call Nolan and say, geez, you had all those. Couldn't you give me one day? The NBA and the National Hockey League playoffs, too, and all the baseball scores and highlights coming up.
Were the Blue Jays crying Mayday today? We're reaching, folks.
Yeah. Dan Patrick and Bob Lee will be there to show you all of those stories tonight. 2-1. Got him on the outside corner to even the count of two balls and two strikes. Did a nice thing here in Kansas City. It just worked out. They had a pitching change when Ryan had two down and the final couple of pitches. They put it up on their big new diamond vision board here. So the fans had a chance to see it. 2-2, runner goes. Nice catch made by Shumpert. Barry Shumpert on a hard line drive. The Royals get one more shot at it. They don't get to it. The Tigers are going to sweep this three-game series. And on this big night in baseball here at Royal Stadium, Gary Thorne, Dave Campbell, and a good one, 6-4. The Royals getting a final shot at it here. Stillwell, McRae, and Shumpert, 7, 8, and 9 in the order, are due up. Mike Hedeman is in a save situation. Bill Gullickson a chance to go 3-0 if Hedeman or whomever it might be hangs on to the lead. There is Hedeman, who already has four saves, four of the six. Gibson and Gleaton have the other two. Stillwell, ball one.
Well, we were talking about the Cowboy Nolan Ryan tonight. The Tigers have their three Cowboys in the lineup tonight, all from Oklahoma State, the Cowboys. Mike Henneman, Mickey Tettleton, and Peter Cavill is a DH tonight.
All there. Stillwell wants to draw the walk. Count is even, though, on the high strike. One ball, one strike. Stillwell scored, getting on in the fielder's choice in the fifth inning. Two unearned runs. McRae had a triple for an RBI. Terry Shumpert had a sacrifice fly for an RBI. Back, one and two.
By the way, the answer was Fran Healer to the question you were supposed to ask me tonight.
Swanson called you, didn't he? Our statistician at ESPN. He called you so I could ask, and then you would know, and I'd go, how the heck did you know?
I refuse to squeal.
For double jeopardy, who was the first player to have an inside-the-park home run here in Kansas City? 1-2 delivery. Stillwell towards second. Whitaker. And there's one away here in the ninth inning. John Saunders.
Cleveland in California. Finley chucking the ball into Albert Bell, who had a tremendous spring. He's been hot and cold during the regular season, but here's another home run, second in 2 days. Junior Felix gives it a chase, but it's gone. Cleveland leads it 3-0 now in the third. Get you back, Gary and Dave in Kansas City.
Busy night for John today.
By the way, it was July 29th, 1973, fourth inning, one out against the California Angels.
You had it already, didn't you? Here's Brian McRae, who had it inside the park last night. Cecil Fielder, and there are two down.
Yeah, I could only lie in wait for so many innings. You were on the cusp. You were talking about Brian McRae and the inside the park homer, 100 and some inside the park homers. Oh, I know.
It's right on my scoreboard.
I mean, you were set up, but somehow you got sidetracked.
Those no hitters and stolen bases today just sidetracked that man. Terry
Poole. Nah, it was
Terry Poole will pinch in.
It was not Mike Swanson, but I will not tell you who.
Okay. Well, I know this park's got to be alive if Francis Xavier Healy can get an inside the park home run, because he's slower than I am.
Hey, the Duke. Of course, Wotham. Wotham was a pretty fast runner, but John Wotham had a couple, the manager of the Royals.
He's all right. That I can see. Terry Poole, just acquired, is the final hope, at least for the moment. Two down, nobody on. Tigers are leading the Royals by a score of 6-4.
Mets let Terry go in spring training. He had an excellent year pinch hitting for the Astros last year, 8-20, but had shoulder surgery. Royals picked him up this past week. Great guy, Terry Poole. Glad to see you hooked on.
Obviously a free agent. He's with Houston all those years from 77 through last year. 281 lifetime hitter. There are two away and nobody on. His job just trying to get on base. Fouls that one off, and the count is one ball and two strikes. Gullickson's almost 3-0, and Henneman almost have his fifth save. A no-hitter, a stolen base record, and the NBA National Hockey League playoffs are all coming up. SportsCenter is next right here on ESPN. Lee and Patrick standing by. 6-4 Tiger lead. A victory here, and they sweep, and they get the go home. A good road trip. Terry Poole fouls it off. Tigers 6-5 on the road trip will be 7-5 with a victory here, and it's their longest road trip of the season. They've got it behind them.
Hey, you know you're going good when you're the Detroit Tigers. They win this. They've won 4 out of 5, and there was some speculation they were going to face Nolan Ryan Friday night in Detroit, but Nolan, I think you know by now, pitched tonight.
The world they don't know will know shortly. 1-2, two away. Edelman's delivery. Terry Poole takes it inside. Two balls and two strikes. We will follow the Detroit Tigers for the first of our doubleheader on Friday night. Detroit will be heading home to take on the Texas Rangers. 2-2 delivery. 3-2. Second half of that doubleheader. Mike Cohart will be there to see the Baltimore Orioles take on the California Angels. That'll be the second half of the doubleheader on Friday night. Ripken on a tear at the plate. Winfield and the Angels putting on a great start. 3-2 delivery. Stays alive.
Terry did, but somebody in the stands almost didn't. Boy, did he hit a bullet up in the seats. Guy's trying to take it out of his rib cage right now. Checking out to see if there's any bone on that.
Keep your eye on the ball. Three, two, two away. Tigers 6, Royals 4. 3-2. And he walked him, and the potential tying run will come to the plate. Mike Henneman has walked 6 now in the 14 innings that he has pitched. Number 31,
David Howard. David Howard in to run for Terry Poole, reserve infielder. You wonder, why do you put a pinch runner in when you're down by 2? It's not that important. Well, it's important. Especially if it's a ball hit deep in the hole, force the infielder to have to throw the ball to first base instead of going the short way to a second on the fourth. So that's why John Wotham makes that move right there.
So Howard will loosen up at first base, and here's Cromartie, a double and a single in his 4 at-bats. Upping that average. And those Royals fans who hung on are hanging in now. Giamatti takes it outside for a ball. Henneman has given up 10 hits, Dave, but only one run in the innings worked.
Little surprise, Rob Deer is playing relatively shallow in right field. In this situation, you want to try to take away the extra base hit.
Play by Fryman. There's the force out at second base. Gullickson wins it to go 3-0. Boddicker the loser, 2-3. Henneman is fifth save.
Pretty much a Tiger formula for victory of late. A little bit of power in the middle of the lineup. Good starting pitching, excellent relief, and the Tigers have a 7-5 road trip and go on an upbeat note.
And another big home run in this one by Tettelin. For Dave Campbell, this is Gary Thorne on behalf of all of our crew. Thank you for joining us. 6-4 Tiger win. John?